The Committee on Homeland Security will come to order. The committee is meeting today to receive testimony on a review of the fiscal year 2020 budget request for the Department of Homeland Security. Today, the committee is meeting to examine the president's budget. This hearing was originally scheduled for earlier this month with Secretary Nielsen, who resigned before the hearing was held. I'd like to welcome our Acting Secretary of Homeland Security, Secretary Kevin McAleen. The Acting Secretary is being asked to defend the budget before us, in my estimation, is very difficult. The Secretary is wearing two hats, as you know. He's been a career employee here in the federal service, and in my mind, has done a good job. I've thanked him on a number of occasions for his work, and I look forward to seeing him and working with him even more in this role. So we welcome you here today. President Trump's budget prioritizes construction of a border wall at the expense of critical homeland security priorities, such as first responder and homeland security grants, cybersecurity programs to defend against foreign spying, and initiatives to secure our transportation systems from terrorist attack. The Acting Secretary's prepared testimony states doing more with less is an acceptable method for achieving mission goals. Yet, this is exactly what the President's budget requests would force key parts of the department to do. The President would squander $8.6 billion in taxpayers' money on a wall that will do nothing to address the current situation on the border. I suspect the Acting Secretary knows that, even if he cannot say it for fear of being the next department official to be dismissed by the White House. And make no mistake, it will be the American people picking up the tab for the wall, not Mexico, as President promised. Congress is preparing to provide additional funding to address the humanitarian crisis on the border, but we cannot allow the President to compromise the rest of the department or our nation's homeland security in the meantime. Unfortunately, rather than engaging with Congress to address the humanitarian crisis and implement sound border policy, the White House only continues to make matters worse. The President fired department officials who tried to offer a voice of reason, cut off aid to Central America intended to help address the root causes of migration, and is sending essential DHS personnel to the border, potentially undermining the department's other critical missions. Frankly, between the vacancies at the department and the reports of infighting coming out of the White House, it's difficult to know who's calling the shots when it comes to the border: the President, the Acting Secretary, or Stephen Miller. Meanwhile, the number of people in CBP's custody continues to rise. We also continue to see shocking photos of families being held in inhumane conditions and children sleeping on the bare ground covered by nothing more than four blankets. And tragically, just this week, yet another child died in the department's custody. But what can we expect from an administration that separated at least 5,000 children from their parents at the border? To the extent this administration has a border policy, it has been an abject failure. It is past time to implement a strategy of common sense solutions to address the humanitarian crisis at the border while ensuring security and upholding our values. First, we need to ensure humanitarian conditions for people in custody, and particularly vulnerable populations like children and pregnant women. The surge in families at our borders does not excuse inhumane treatment or relieve us of an obligation to treat people with basic decency. As I mentioned, Congress is engaging with this administration to provide supplemental funding. Second, we need more immigration judges and asylum officers to increase capacity to handle asylum claims and address the longstanding immigration court backlog. Third, we need to expand proven cost-effective alternatives to detention to ensure people show up for their court dates as scheduled while their cases proceed. Finally, we need to help address the root causes prompting people to come north by restoring aid to Central American countries acting as partners in addressing this crisis. We can protect our borders and our homeland while also protecting our American values. The President and the White House have not proven up to that task, but I hope the Acting Secretary will partner with Congress in that effort. In closing, I want to thank the over 240,000 men and women in the Department of Homeland Security for the work they do to secure our nation every day. From the Coast Guard personnel patrolling our coast and waterways to the Customs and Border Protection officers at our land borders to the transportation security officers I see as I fly to and from Jackson, Mississippi every week and everywhere in between, we appreciate the work you do. I thank the members for joining us, and I look forward to our discussion. I'll now recognize the ranking member of the full committee, the gentleman from Alabama, Mr. Rogers, for an opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Secretary McLennan, for being here with us today. I look forward to your testimony and discussion that we're going to have. There is a national security and humanitarian crisis at the border. That is why I supported the President's February National Emergency Declaration. The facts on the border prove it. CBP detained more than 109,000 immigrants along the southwest border just last month. That's a 591% increase over the same month 2 years ago. On May 4th of this year, CBP apprehended 5,235 migrants at the southwest border. That's the highest number ever recorded. In the first 6 months of FY19, over 150 groups of 100 or more migrants reached the southwest border. That's a 7,400% increase over the entirety of FY17. CBP apprehensions between the ports of entry are on track to reach a 12-year high. CBP has already uncovered more than 3,000 fraudulent cases this year alone where adults posing as biological parent or legal guardian of a minor child. If this isn't a crisis, I'm not sure what this committee deems to be one. Actually, we do. Yesterday, the Transportation Subcommittee held a hearing entitled, quote, "The TSA Workforce Crisis, a Homeland Security Risk." I appreciate the TSA workforce has issues, but I would say that thousands of migrants per day overrunning and breaking our immigration system is the actual crisis and the true homeland security risk. This will be the committee's sixth hearing in 5 months focused on the border. How many hearings before we see solutions coming from this majority? Six hearings, zero solutions. This committee has heard testimony that transnational criminal organizations are exploiting our immigration laws for financial gains. Worse, these TCOs abuse women and children during their journey here. They dump them at in the desert in poor health without food or water. Men and women and children are dying because of this dangerous journey human smugglers profit from. I know that no one on this committee finds this acceptable, so why won't this committee address it? In April, DHS requested legislation to address this aberrant practice, here we are in another hearing, and I don't understand why this committee won't act. Maybe it's because this committee is spending too much of its time on Twitter. Since the Democrats were sworn into office in January, they have tweeted 316 times about the border. Six hearings, 316 tweets, zero solutions. On May 1st, the administration sent to Congress a request for emergency humanitarian appropriations to address this crisis at the southwest border. The request for $4.5 billion would feed and shelter migrant families and unaccompanied children. It would provide urgent medical care and transportation services to sick migrants. It also would have supported the men and women of DHS who are working overtime on the front lines of the crisis. Yet the majority of this committee sent out press release refusing to consider the request. When I drafted this emergency humanitarian request as an amendment to the supplemental, the Democrat majority on the Rules Committee voted it down 9-4 when Representative Lesko offered it at markup. Six hearings, 316 tweets, one amendment denied, zero results. I hope my colleagues on the other side of the aisle will use this opportunity today to ask Secretary McLennan what resources his department needs to fulfill its lawful mission at the southwest border. The Republicans on this committee are ready to work with anyone on the other side to solve the growing humanitarian crisis. Hearings, tweets, releases won't solve it. Hatred for the president won't solve it either. We can't wait two more years to address this southwest border crisis. We must act now. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Other members of the committee are reminded that under the committee rules, opening statements may be submitted for the record. I welcome our witness today, Mr. McElhaney. I was sworn in as the Acting Secretary of Homeland Security on April 10th, 2019. Prior to being named Acting Secretary, he served as Commissioner of the U.S. Customs and Border Protection. Acting Secretary previously held several leadership positions at CBP and the former U.S. Customs Service. Without objection, the witness's full statement will be inserted in the record. I now ask the Acting Secretary to summarize his statement for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and good morning. Ranking Member Rogers and the distinguished members of the committee, I appreciate the opportunity to appear before you today. It's a sincere honor to serve as the Acting Secretary of the Department of Homeland Security. In my view, DHS has the most compelling mission in government to safeguard the American people, our homeland, and our values. As Acting Secretary, I intend to work with this committee and serve as an advocate for the department to ensure our people have the resources and the authorities they need to carry out their critical missions on behalf of the American people. Today, I have the privilege of sharing the President's fiscal year 2020 budget request for the Department of Homeland Security with this committee. The request would strengthen the security of our nation through enhanced border security, immigration enforcement, cybersecurity, transportation security, counterterrorism, and resilience to disasters. DHS is a multi-mission department, and before I talk about the urgent border security and humanitarian crisis that we're facing, I want to ensure this committee that DHS will not lose momentum across any of our numerous responsibilities. The President's budget requests funding for critical missions across the department. For our Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency, the budget requests $1.3 billion to assess evolving cybersecurity risks, protect federal government information systems, and critical infrastructure. The budget also supports the launch of Protect 2020, a new initiative designed to get all states to a baseline level of election infrastructure cybersecurity well before the national elections of 2020. While DHS does not control state and local election infrastructure and does not think we should, we can provide much needed technical assistance and support to willing partners. The budget supports additional transportation security officers to enhance security effectiveness and stay ahead of increasing costs and growth in air travel within the United States. The $3.3 billion for TSA also includes funding for an additional 700 screeners and 350 computed tomography X-ray units. For FEMA, the budget provides a significant increase in the Disaster Relief Fund, begins implementation of new requirements in the Disaster Recovery Reform Act, and funds critical operational positions identified in the 2017 hurricane season after action report. For the U.S. Coast Guard, the budget continues efforts to fund the offshore patrol cutter and advances the polar security cutter program. A lot there for across the department and all of our missions. But for border security and immigration enforcement, as you are all aware, we are in the midst of an ongoing security and humanitarian crisis at our southwest border. The department, at the request of our frontline officers and agents, has repeatedly made clear that we need additional resources and additional authorities to respond to this crisis. To put the situation in context, in April, CBP apprehended and encountered almost 110,000 migrants attempting to cross without legal status, the most in a single month in over a decade, and over a third of the total crossings we saw in all of fiscal year 17. Over 65% of those crossings were families, with over 40,000 children entering our immigration system in a single month. And the crisis continues. In three separate days in May, we have encountered 5,500 people crossing our border without authorization. Our immigration system is full, and we are well beyond our capacity at every stage of the process. This means that new waves of vulnerable populations arriving at our border are exacerbating the already urgent humanitarian and security crisis we are facing. Through surging resources from DHS and federal partners, with medical teams from the Coast Guard and HHS, military and National Guard troops, over 1,000 CBP and HSI detailees and DHS volunteers, along with working with state and local governments and non-governmental organizations, we are working to do everything we possibly can to address the immediate and dire humanitarian crisis. But it is not enough. We continue to face tragedies at the border, particularly with regard to the safety of children. This month, Border Patrol agents have rescued dozens of children in the Rio Grande, but several have been known to have drowned, including a 10-month-old baby 2 weeks ago. We've lost two teenagers to illness in federal custody, one with HHS and one in CBP custody just yesterday. A two-year-old encountered in April when taken to the hospital by Border Patrol agents and released with her mother also passed away this month after weeks of critical medical care. These tragedies are devastating to us, and they are avoidable. The problem we face is unprecedented and challenging. It requires working together from a shared set of facts to solve it. We need sustained investment, additional emergency support, but also changes to our immigration laws to overcome this humanitarian and security crisis at the border. On the resources front, the President's budget will help. First, it requests $523 million to address the humanitarian crisis. This will allow us to provide better care for those who we come into contact with through apprehension, custody, detention, and eventually removal. It requests $5 billion for border security, funding for the construction of approximately 200 miles of new border wall system, a proven deterrent requested by our frontline agents. It also calls for 750 additional Border Patrol agents, 275 Customs and Border Protection officers, and over 1,660 ICE frontline and support personnel. The budget request will make much-needed upgrade to sensors, command and control systems, and aircraft to help our men and women combat criminals who are profiting from human suffering. And while our 2020 budget will help address this crisis, we will need additional funding sooner. Given the scale, we will exhaust our resources well before the end of this fiscal year, which is why the administration sent a supplemental funding request to Congress 3 weeks ago. In addition to the $3 billion for Health and Human Services to care for unaccompanied children, the request includes $1.1 billion for the Department of Homeland Security, $391 million for humanitarian assistance, including for temporary processing facilities, $530 million for border operations to include our surge personnel, as well as increased detention capacity, and $178 million for operations and support costs, including pay retention incentives for our overworked men and women on the front line. The supplemental request is critical, but unless Congress addresses the pull factors, namely our vulnerable legal framework for immigration, children will continue to be put at risk in this dangerous journey. The administration has been working in a bipartisan fashion to outline the important reforms that can get to the root of the problem, providing language to multiple congressional committees that would end this humanitarian crisis. This includes allowing DHS to detain families together during the immigration hearings, allowing children to safely apply for refugee protections in their home or neighboring countries, while also providing authority for DHS to repatriate children to Central America, as we do with Canada and Mexico today, and reforming an asylum process that has become overwhelmed by claims that do not meet the standard. Without these resources and authorities, the situation will remain untenable. And while DHS will continue to do all it can to manage the crisis in an operationally effective, humane, safe, and secure manner, every day Congress does not act puts more lives at risk and increases the burden on an overtaxed system. I want to close by reiterating the strength of DHS is its people. I am humbled and inspired by their selfless dedication of the frontline agents, officers, and personnel confronting this crisis. Despite the challenges they face, the men and women of DHS continue to act to stop criminals exploiting our border and to help those in need. They are remarkable people. They deserve our support, and I respectfully ask this committee to continue to support them with the resources and authorities they need. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. I remind each member that he or she will have 5 minutes to question the panel. I now recognize myself for questions. This is a hearing to talk about the overall budget for the department. One of the questions that comes to mind is the relief that went to Puerto Rico. And I want to make sure the record reflects that. Now, the President says that Puerto Rico got $91 billion. Is that true or false?
I'm certain that's correct, Mr. Chairman. I can get you the actual figures from FEMA, if that's helpful.
How long would it take you to get to that number?
We can get back to you very shortly.
Today?
I'll check with the team at FEMA on that calculation, but we'll get it back to you, Mr. Chairman.
Well, yeah, right. I've been to Puerto Rico a couple of times looking at it. I talked to the governor, talked to a lot of the mayors, and they are very concerned that the number that's been put out is in actuality not the real number. And so I think we need to as we look at this budget, to make sure that the numbers we have before us reflect an accurate amount. And so that's the spirit in which it's given.
Mr. Chairman, just very briefly, I've met with the acting administrator for FEMA, who's briefed me that we're spending more per week and per month in Puerto Rico than we do for a usual disaster for the entire repayment and the entire assistance. So it's an extensive effort by FEMA and across the department.
Well, is that because we've never had a disaster like that before?
I think it is one of the most devastating natural disasters in our history.
So you would agree that we need to spend more?
I think there's a lot of support going to Puerto Rico, and we're actively preparing for the new season.
I understand. But I think the amount of money should go toward the disaster. So in addition to that, Mr. Secretary, you have asked for volunteers to go to the border to address the crisis. Can you tell me how many people are being deployed from the northern border to go to the southern border?
So we have a mix of law enforcement resources from both CBP and HSI over at ICE already deployed. These are TD-wide law enforcement professionals. We do this routinely to address situations on the border. We've got about 200 of our agents from the northern border, Border Patrol agents, deployed down now. And we have solicited, as you noted, Mr. Chairman, for volunteers, just like we do in any crisis across the department, to come help deal with the situation as well.
So your testimony is that the volunteers that are being deployed does not compromise security in any way?
So this is something we look at from a risk managed perspective. When we respond to a natural disaster like a Harvey or Maria, we had over 2,000 volunteers deployed. So right now our volunteer numbers are really in the 200 range. So that's a much smaller response than a normal natural disaster already. But this is something we ask our leaders and our management to assess for risk and make sure we're not, you know, taking people that are critical to other missions, but also responding to an existing crisis at the same time.
So we've had testimony before the committee this week from the head of one of the larger airports who indicated that he was very concerned that with the loss of personnel, that the potential to put the traveling public at risk existed, and that he was concerned about it. Have you heard concerns like that from airports?
So we're not going to put the traveling public at risk. We're not going to reduce our security posture in any way.
But you have heard that concern coming from airport directors.
So that's a concern that the leaders at TSA will manage as they identify volunteers to support us. We have not sent.
I understand that. I just want to know, have you heard from airport directors that they are concerned about it?
Yes, I've seen the press reporting, and certainly that's something we'll manage carefully.
And it is hope that you will allay their concerns, but you have heard them.
Yes.
Thank you. So the question about vacancies in the department, we've had discussions about that. How are you addressing the vacancies at senior management level within the department?
Well, we were very happy earlier this month to submit a nomination for a permanent administrator at FEMA. I think that's an important role to fill very quickly in this hurricane season with Jeff Byard. But our top eight operating components, four out of eight have confirmed or permanent heads. Two of them, TSA and CBP, were serving as acting secretary and acting deputy, but were confirmed heads as well, backfilled by very talented career professionals. And then at ICE, we have a 25-year veteran of service, Matt Albans, leading ICE effectively. And this is something that I think we're in very good position to maintain our momentum at the department.
Thank you, but based on the chart that your staff provided me, your management directorate is vacant, your science and technology directorate is vacant, the Office of Strategy, Policy, and Plans is vacant, the Office of Public Affairs is vacant, the Office of Inspector General is vacant, the chief financial office is vacant, and we go on and on. Now this is, and I understand that, but at what point do you plan to fill the vacancies with these senior positions?
Well, a number of those positions already have nominees either on the Hill or identified and in process. And we've taken steps to make sure we're backfilling with talented professionals. Right now, Director Tex Ollis from the Secret Service, who just moved to a position as Acting Deputy Undersecretary for Management. He brings a wealth of experience, having been the deputy at CBP, the head of Secret Service. He's helping make sure that we're maintaining our momentum with management. We have a tremendous team in the CFO shop that hasn't lost any momentum. So we're going to continue to get the job done for the American people. We have many more permanent folks in place than you usually do at the transition of an administration, for example.
So is this the Secret Service director that got fired by the president?
He's been moved to a key role for me,
but he was fired by the president. And you brought him back.
There was a transition. He served admirably for 2 years at Secret Service, and now we have a tremendous Secret Service agent taking that role.
I don't have a problem with it, but he's the one that was fired. Am I correct?
He's been moved to a new role at DHS.
Okay. Yield to the ranking member.
I thank the chairman. Before I get my questions, I just want to make the point, I think it's unconscionable that relief to deal with this humanitarian crisis at the border is being held hostage for Puerto Rico to get more money when already we're having massive amounts of aid going to Puerto Rico, have been and continue to have, and will continue to take care of Puerto Rico. But we have an enormous crisis at the border, families, children that are in desperate situation, and we're not getting aid to them. It's just unconscionable. But having said that, of the $4.5 billion that's been requested, Mr. Secretary, I understand 3.3 of that would go to humanitarian aid. What would you do with that money if it was made available to you in a timely fashion?
So the $3 billion itself is going to Health and Human Services to manage their statutorily required responsibility to care for unaccompanied children arriving at the border, and they're arriving in record numbers right now. That seems very straightforward. They need more money to provide beds so that kids can be kept in safe environments and not left at the border in Border Patrol stations. So that's very straightforward. The additional $1.1 billion for DHS is directly to address this crisis. We're talking about humanitarian support for processing centers for CBP. We're talking about additional security for those centers. We're talking about consumables, really just food, blankets, the basic supplies that you use to care for people. And for border operations, as we noted, we are sending people temporarily to the border to help address this crisis. That costs a lot of money to do that and to sustain that. We need support for the volunteer surge. We need additional ICE detention for the single adults that are arriving in record numbers as well. So we've got a lot of work to do across the department to manage this crisis, both to take care of people in our custody and to ensure that we're maintaining border security while we do that.
Now, the chairman and I had a chance to meet with you yesterday afternoon, and we talked a little bit about the Flores decision and what its impact has been on you. Can you describe that for the full committee and what a possible solution would be?
I can. So what we're seeing now is about 65% of those crossings are either family units or unaccompanied children. Family units have reached a record level, 59% so far this month, of our total crossings on the border. That is a direct response to the vulnerability in our legal framework caused by a decision in a district court in late 2015, upheld in 2016, that prevented DHS from keeping families together during their immigration proceedings. That's what we did under President Obama and Secretary Johnson. They built family residential centers where families were kept together for their immigration proceedings. It took on average about 45 days. And at the end of that process, and these are appropriate settings that have schoolhouses, they have recreational facilities, they have medical centers, they have courtrooms on site. After those proceedings, families would know whether they had a valid asylum claim and be allowed to stay in the U.S. or they would be repatriated. As soon as those repatriations started happening, the flow dropped dramatically from our first border crisis in 2014 with families and kids. We no longer have that tool, we no longer have that authority, and now we have twice the flow coming in a direct response to that lack of our authority.
And what could we do to alleviate that problem for you?
Simply return to the status that we had in 2014-2015, allowing families to be kept together in appropriate settings during their immigration proceedings.
Well, my understanding from our meeting yesterday is that you're going to provide us language that would do that. And it's my hope that the chairman and I can bring that before this committee for a vote as soon as possible so we can get you some relief. Now, in addition to that legislative remedy, what other legislative remedies would you like to see us move?
So the second issue that's really concerning is the unaccompanied children, putting themselves in the hands of smugglers. Generally, these are teenage boys and girls that are being smuggled $5,000 to $7,000 per person all the way from Central America to our border. Right now, they're coming because they're certain they'll be allowed to stay. They're generally released to sponsors here in the U.S., generally parents who are already here unlawfully. So it's a very challenging cycle that we're facing. What the administration is proposing, I think, is very balanced and very appropriate to protect children, offering in-country refugee processing so that they can access protections if they have a valid claim at home without making this journey, without being in the hands of smugglers. But to make that effective, we also need the ability to repatriate children, just like we do for Canada and Mexico, who arrive in the U.S. who do not avail themselves of this opportunity or have not been found to have a valid refugee claim. I think that's a balanced proposal that we'd like to work with Congress on in enacting. Those two changes in law will make a dramatic impact in this humanitarian crisis.
Great. I appreciate you, and my time's expired. I yield back.
Thank you. The chair recognizes the gentlelady from Texas for 5 minutes.
Chairman, thank you, and thank the ranking member for this very important oversight hearing. Secretary, I have a very short period of time, so forgive me, but let me first of all say that you are a very fine public servant. We've had the opportunity of working over the years, and I would hesitate to say decade, because we all are very young. So thank you for your service. Let me ask you, in the president's budget is $5 billion for the wall. Are you here today to defend the $5 billion request for the wall?
I'm defending the entire budget request, and that is a request that comes from our frontline agents. It's not something we need everywhere on the border, but we need hundreds of miles to control critical areas where there's infrastructure on both sides and high traffic.
The $5 billion, as you well know, was represented to be coming from Mexico. Is it coming from Mexico?
No, it would be. It's requested for appropriation.
So the representation was untrue?
I'm not characterizing reputation. Representation is untrue. It's
did the numbers from the border persons come at the exact number of $5 billion?
So that's the amount that we can effectively apply in a given year with contracts.
This is the president's request?
Yes. We actually need about $18 billion for the top 17.
In his request or in his budget as well, let me indicate that he has cut $600 million from first responder Homeland Security grants. I want my firefighters to hear this very clearly because I will oppose it extensively. U.S. Coast Guard has cut $864 million. Surface transportation programs, $57 million or 44%. And cybersecurity, which is known to have impacted the 2016-2018 elections, have been cut by $40 million. Are you here to defend those cuts, Mr. Secretary?
So on the side of the grants, Congresswoman, what I've understood is that we've deployed $50 billion in Homeland Security grants over the past decade.
But you're here to defend the $600 million cuts to our firefighters and other first responders across the nation.
So I'm defending the president's budget and explaining that we've had a number of grants go to build up capability across the country.
My time is short, okay. Secretary, and I appreciate it. I indicated I appreciate your service. We now have a list of numbers of children that have died in custody. We should all be outraged. 16-year-old boy, Mr. Hernandez Vasquez, Juan de Leon, 16, 7-year-old, 8-year-old, 2-year-old, and there may be others. These are the conditions that individuals, human beings, are living in, and I understand the crisis, and might I say, I've been to the border many, many times and as well understand that it's not tweets. It really is going and seeing it for yourself. I have seen it. I've spoken to people. I've spoken to a mother who's gave birth 45 days and had not been to the hospital, and your CBP staff agreed with me to take her to the hospital. But my question is, I believe there should be an internal task force set up dealing with children, dealing with children's death. My question to you is, will you set up an internal in-house task force to deal with not, the individuals that are there now, and as you know, you have nobody hardly there, to deal with these deaths, to find what solutions should be put in place? My second question would be what you're doing about added medical staff there at the border, and if you would do that quickly, because I have another question, please, sir.
Very
would you
quickly.
Set up an internal task force to deal with this crisis
very quickly.
Of children's deaths?
I agree, Congresswoman. Those conditions are not acceptable. That's why we've asked for additional support from Congress to address it. In El Paso alone, we have 55 medical professionals on board.
Would you agree to add more, please, sir?
It's a constant focus. That is the primary focus of CBP.
And would you agree for the internal task force?
We already have internal task forces working these issues.
Who are they? Can you give us the names of those individuals, please?
I will absolutely provide those to the
community. And that is called an internal task force dealing with children's death. The American people are outraged.
I share their outrage.
Let me finish my other question. First of all, I hope you'll look into the case of Laura Elizabeth Mandidia Alvarado, who was deported as an 11-year-old in my congressional district. We saved her. Family is seeking asylum. They have reason from El Salvador, and we believe that the DHS and your humanitarian status can help her with that. My last thing is, aviation is important. TSA needs jobs, needs personnel. They are the front line of aviation security, not safety. Mr. Secretary, your position on making sure that the Transportation Security Agency has all the staff they need to protect the aviation system in this nation and internationally.
Absolutely required. And that's why I support the budget and the increase of TSOs that it contains.
I yield back.
Thank you. Chair recognizes the gentleman from New York, Mr. King.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And at the outset, let me share the chairman's thought of what a privilege it's been to work with you, Mr. Secretary, in my dealings with you. You've been extremely responsive and courteous, and I thank you for that, and also for your years of service. I'm going to focus on two issues. One is, I keep trying to remind everyone that this committee began after 9/11. It was originated mainly for the purpose of counterterrorism. Obviously, immigration is vital, and I support what you're trying to do. On the issue of counterterrorism, no. The fact is, beginning under the Obama administration and the first three budgets of the Trump administration, there have been dramatic cuts in the money going to police and fire. Like in New York alone, there are over 1,000 police officers working full-time on counterterrorism. To me, there's no way we can absorb those cuts. And in each of these years, the money has been restored, both under the Obama administration and under the Trump administration. And again, I'm hopeful that that money will be restored again. But I hope that that doesn't indicate any diminution of interest by the department as far as cooperating and working to stop a terrorist attack. My district lost over 150 people on 9/11. We still have people dying from 9/11 illnesses. And to see that kind of money being cut out, which would really undercut the police counterterrorism and intelligence units in New York. And I'm not trying to make this parochial, but that was why the department was created. So I just, again, I don't mean this in a pandering way, but if you could just acknowledge that this is still a prime focus of the department, and if the money is restored, the money will be spent properly by the department.
I can confirm both of those things. I mean, Congressman, we appreciate your long expertise and support on the counterterrorism mission. My second trip as acting secretary was to New York to highlight the CT issues. I visited the 9/11 Museum again just to get refreshed and focused on our mission and requirements. It does not reflect any lack of priority for the department in this mission set. It remains why we're created, our top priority for the American people, and we're going to continue to stay focused on it and be effective at it.
Thank you, Secretary. On the issue of MS-13, this was particularly vital in my district. From the fall of 2015 until April of 2017, we had 25 murders carried out by MS-13. These are the most brutal type of murderers, people being hacked to death, beheaded. It was absolutely horrible. Since the administration got actively involved, there's not been one murder in the last 2 years. It's a story that's not really reported. But the increase in HSI, the increased number of prosecutors by the administration, the new technology going to the police, has been extremely effective. Now, MS-13 is down, but they're not out, and they're still a very potent force. And on the issue of unaccompanied minors, it was the Suffolk County Police Commissioner, who, by the way, was appointed by Democratic administration. This is not a partisan issue. He was the one who first came to me to show the direct correlation between unaccompanied minors and MS-13. Now, many of these young people, maybe it's only 3-4%, but it's 3-4% of a big number, were either sent across by MS-13 or the sponsoring families were either MS-13 families or families who had relatives back in El Salvador who were being threatened. In a recent murder indictment, 7 of the 11 who indicted for the murder were unaccompanied minors. They had come across the border in just the last 4 years as unaccompanied minors. Schools like in Brentwood and Central Islip, the students were put in there and They were never told by DHS or by ORR or HHS that these children were unaccompanied minors. They were not given any background on their criminal history of them or their families that have taken them in. I know there's a memorandum of understanding with you and HHS, I guess, and ORR. Can you say whether or not, as a result of the investigations, the vetting that will be carried out of the minors and the families, will the local police and school districts be made, will that info be made available to them?
So thank you first for your comments on the work of ICE and HSI to address public safety threats in our country, and specifically in communities affected by MS-13. That's going to continue to be a priority and focus for the department. We're very worried about gangs exploiting this crisis to send unaccompanied children, teenagers, who they've already recruited into the U.S. That can go through our process and be released to a sponsor here in the U.S. with an intent to join a gang. That's a serious concern. We also see families bringing children who are not their own. 3,500 cases of fraud this year. We have an HSI team that's been on the border for 2 weeks working these issues in El Paso and RGV alone. They've found 500 interviews. They found 165 cases of fraud. They're getting prosecutions of these adults that are bringing families in. And we're seeing, unfortunately, even child recycling, children being brought across twice. You mentioned the critical partnership with HHS. We did have an MOA on information sharing that's been suspended by a rider in the appropriations bill. That diminishes our ability to provide security. It diminishes our ability to share information on the sponsors who are picking up children, on their immigration status, on their potential criminal history, and that's a barrier that should not be there because it's critical. Last point I'll make is the Attorney General just went to Central America to focus on the anti-gang initiatives and the collaboration between the Department of Justice and authorities in El Salvador and elsewhere. That's been a very effective tool because we're getting additional information on criminal records and gang history in Central America that we can then apply at the border and in concert with our DOJ counterparts. So we need to keep that up.
And when time has expired, I would just emphasize that a number of those murders, brutal, brutal murders, were carried out by unaccompanied minors. Thank you.
Chair recognizes gentlelady from New Mexico, Ms. Tara Small.
Secretary McAleenan, thank you for your service and for stepping up at a time that is challenging all of us. I only have 5 minutes and we have a lot of work to do, so I appreciate the efficiency in your responses so far and ask that you continue. Rio Grande sector has the largest number of apprehensions for families and unaccompanied minors, correct? And El Paso sector is second?
Correct.
Yuma's third?
Correct.
Okay, so we've received notification that CBP is working with ICE to provide aircraft flights and bus transportation for unprocessed families and or migrants in from Rio Grande Valley and Yuma sectors to other lower level sectors, right?
Right.
Why isn't El Paso receiving the same service?
They are on the list. There's going to be a flight from El Paso this week.
So we received clarification this morning that that flight was only a stopover for refueling. Is that inaccurate?
I'm told by CBP that they have a flight going to San Diego sector where we have some additional capacity.
That's
so I'll follow up on that, Congressman.
That would be amazing. Okay. If there's any way we can do that, I deeply appreciate that it's something you note is important.
Yes.
Great.
El Paso has seen the starkest increase in family units, as you know.
Absolutely. And thank you for recognizing that and responding to it. Pivoting quickly to Border Patrol OR releases. After Border Patrol processes family units, what are the steps that CBP takes to decide when and where large groups are released?
Yeah, so this is something we have to work closely with local communities, with non-governmental organizations. We want to make sure there's capacity in the transportation system or in the NGOs to house people effectively so that we're not leaving them in situations that are uncomfortable and unacceptable.
Thank you so much for saying that. I truly believe that you understand the challenges that the communities I represent are experiencing. Is there a requirement to do that consultation with NGOs and local governments?
That is CBP policy. That's our expectation of our field leadership.
Thank you. And is it a requirement or just expectation?
It's a stated direction from the Chief of the Border Patrol and the Executive Assistant Commissioner for Field Operations.
Great. And is there a time amount for advance notice that's provided in that direction?
It as much as could be provided so that it can be effectively coordinated. Sometimes a situation of the numbers in custody mandate a quicker action. We're also sometimes not having the right point of contact. I've got some feedback from New Mexico Senator yesterday on these issues, and we're going to be tightening that coordination.
Great. To any extent, if you could set a minimum amount of time of notice, that would be very helpful.
I think we can set an expectation, but we wouldn't want to direct from Washington all field situations operationally.
So speaking to that, who ultimately makes the decisions of when and where a release occurs?
Those would be the sector chief locally.
And are there directives that come from Washington advising on when and where?
Yes, as I mentioned, we've given guidance to the field on our expectations for coordination.
Thank you. So now to migrant processing. In conversations with both ICE and CBP, it's apparent that both agents believe that neither of them should be responsible for processing asylum seekers. Border Patrol says that ICE has the better resources for processing. CBP, or ICE, believes that Border Patrol has the responsibility because they're the first to encounter migrants. This disconnect seems to exacerbate scarcity in resources, and it seems to stem from a lack of leadership saying simply who's responsible. So, Mr. McAleenan, what agency is responsible for processing asylum seekers?
So, actually, that's CIS, if you're talking about doing an asylum officer interview. But just to clarify, I think I want to get at the point of your question. As I'm acting secretary, we're going to handle this as a team. This is a mission that's overtaxed CBP, ICE, CIS, HHS, and the Department of Justice Immigration Courts. No element of that system is adequately resourced for the flow that we're seeing. So we have to address it as a team. We're seeing that with our transportation. In El Paso sector, which you're most familiar with because it covers New Mexico, the transportation is done exclusively by CBP. Originally, the intent was for ICRO to handle transportation. We're filling gaps, working together, and that's my expectation.
And I appreciate that, but clarity is also helpful for working as a team. So is there a clear directive of who is responsible for putting together the paperwork and the notice to appear?
So depending on the local area, the available resources, we're going to try to apply the best effort to that. Border Patrol is supposed to be on the border doing interdictions. ICE is supposed to be doing processing and removal or interior enforcement. Right,
so
now
ICE is
they're
supposed
both,
to be doing processing?
Generally, yes. Okay. Right now they're both handling the processing of family units, depending on the station or sector.
So there's no directive right now about who, even two specific areas, there's no specific directive.
The directive is to work together to get this mission done as efficiently and as effectively as possible.
Thank you.
Thank you. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Louisiana, Mr. Hickens, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, thank you for your service, sir, and thank you for maintaining your professional bearing despite some of the tone you face today. My colleagues across the aisle mentioned the word squander regarding the president's budget. Well, the American treasure is certainly subject to close scrutiny by the American people that provide it. The American people certainly do recognize the well-established fact that politicians and bureaucrats in D.C. squander the money seized from the paychecks of working Americans. However, the citizenry does not consider national security, homeland security, to be a waste of money. I can name scores of federal expenditures that squander the people's treasure, but securing our borders and maintaining our very sovereignty is perhaps the single most important mission the federal government should accomplish, and is certainly not squandering. Decisions regarding the essential needs of law enforcement to secure our homeland should be determined by the Department of Homeland Security, law enforcement professionals, not by career politicians in D.C., and unknown, unelected bureaucrats. So thank you, sir, for representing those law enforcement professionals and their needs today. I ask you, is the Department of Homeland Security making progress towards achieving operational control of our southwest border?
We are. Through a combination of the investments in 18, the received funding in 19, the border barrier is going to make a big impact.
Roger that. Will the president's budget, as submitted, if approved by this Congress, would it help you to accomplish your mission?
Absolutely. It will accelerate our efforts.
Thank you, sir. Since President Trump entered office, how many replacement miles, secondary miles, or new linear miles of enhanced physical barrier system have been funded on the southwest border, and how many have been completed or are currently being built? Give us an idea of that, please.
Sure. So out of the $3.6 billion in FY 17, 18, 19 funding, and money from the Treasury Forfeiture Fund. We're applying that currently to fund a total of 336 miles of border wall.
You're getting the job done, sir.
Yes.
With the money that's been provided.
We're going to get part of the job done.
Roger that.
And we've asked for more.
And you need, as a law enforcement professional, as a Secretary of Department of Homeland Security, in charge of securing our southern border and the sovereignty of our nation, do you concur with the budget request as it's been submitted?
I absolutely do, and this request comes from our men and women on the ground, the capabilities.
As it should. The approximately 300 miles for the fiscal year 2020 budget to be prioritized along the southwest border. That's my understanding. Can you explain why?
Why it would be prioritized?
Why that money would be prioritized for enhanced physical barrier along the southwest border, particularly. Explain to the American people why, please.
Yeah, southwest border has two dynamics on the border security front. We've got 30 to 40,000 people a month trying to evade capture crossing that border, and we have increasing amounts of drug smuggling. And we're talking about hard narcotics, potent opioids like fentanyl, synthetic opioids, that are killing Americans and communities all over the country.
Many Americans are dying from this poison pouring across our border. I would concur. And will enhance physical barriers as requested by the Department of Homeland Security and as evaluated as necessary by the law enforcement professionals on the ground, do you concur that enhanced physical barriers will help you accomplish your mission?
Yes.
Thank you. What technological advancements along the borders have been implemented generally, and how will the fiscal year 2020 budget further those investments?
I'll make three key points on that. One, every mile of border barrier comes with technology. It comes with fiber optic sensors, cameras, lighting. It's not just a dumb wall. It's fully supported by technology that tells our agents what's happening in those areas.
Secondly, you said something. It is indeed a quote-unquote smart wall, is
indeed.
It not, good sir?
No question. It's a smart barrier. Secondly, the 2020 budget would continue to fund our innovative tower effort to provide surveillance capability in those areas where we don't have border barrier to extend our view of the border and cue agents on where to respond. Third, it would put sensors in aircraft that are higher resolution and that are modernized that help surveil the border from the air.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Yes or no, if Congress passed a law correcting the flaws and loopholes in the Flores settlement, would that help us control this flow?
That would help dramatically.
Thank you, sir. I yield, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Chair, I recognize the gentlelady from Illinois, Ms. Underwood.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Acting Secretary McAleenan, you told MSNBC that families at the border are being separated in a humane and civilized way. Let me tell you, sir, that the people of Illinois' 14th District do not think that this policy is civilized. And as a nurse, I can tell you that it's definitely not humane. And we know that there are alternatives like family case management that keep our country safe and secure without traumatizing innocent kids. Yes or no, can you commit that DHS will not restart family separations under your leadership?
So the President of the United States has said that we're not looking at doing that again.
So
there's
under
an executive
your
order in place that says we're not going to take zero tolerance prosecutions, not family separations, but prosecuting adults that are violating the law and resulted in separations. We're not going to restart that right now.
Okay, so you have made a commitment then that you will not restart family separations under your leadership.
So I think the President's statement suffices as a commitment for the administration.
Okay. Now I want to know whether you're aware of what family separation does to children's mental and physical health. I only have 5 minutes, so for these questions, I'm looking for a yes or no answer, sir. Are you aware of research showing that family separation causes trauma that can do both immediate and long-term damage to children's health? Yes or no?
So you're asking questions about something that's not happening, Congresswoman. So the separations that are occurring now are only in result of the prosecution of the adult for a serious criminal
offense.
I'm
not asking about that.
Welfare of the child, communicable
disease. Claiming my time, that was not the line of questioning. My questioning was, are you aware of the impact of family separation and the trauma on children's long-term physical and mental health?
Okay, again, you're asking about something that we're not doing. So I'm not sure this line of question is going to be effective.
The question is, are you aware? Are you, sir, as the acting secretary of DHS, aware of research that shows that family separation causes trauma?
Yeah, I've talked to Dr. Colleen Kraft of the American Association of Pediatricians. I am aware of the research, and
Thank
we
you.
Solicit support and input from pediatricians in managing our responsibilities at the border.
Great. Are you aware that the trauma of family separation is connected to something called toxic stress?
Yes, again, you're asking about something we're not doing.
Great, but you're aware.
Yeah, I'm aware of the research, as I noted.
And then are you aware that toxic stress can actually change a child's brain because it's still developing, yes or no?
I've read the study.
Okay, great. Are you aware that the effects of these traumas are cumulative, that they get worse the longer the trauma goes on?
I think I've answered this line of questioning.
Yes.
I've already said I'm familiar.
Okay, are you aware that the traumatic effects don't go away even if a child is reunited with their family?
Again, you're asking about something we're not doing, so yes, I'm aware, and it's not being done.
Are you aware that family separation can lead to behavioral changes and learning delays for children?
I think I've answered this line of questioning. I've already answered. You're talking about the same research.
Mr. Secretary, just answer the question, yes or no. I'm probably the most reasonable chairman. Just answer the question. She just say yes or no.
I've already answered yes, Mr. Chairman. It's the same study that she's citing in different parts of it. So if I've acknowledged that I'm familiar with it, that's probably sufficient.
It's not.
Okay.
Yes, you're aware.
Yes.
Okay. Are you aware that family separation can lead to behavioral changes and learning delays for children?
Yes, I've read the study.
Are you aware that it increases a child's risk of heart disease, diabetes, and cancer?
Yes, I've read the study.
Okay. Are you aware that it increases a child's risk of anxiety, depression, and substance abuse?
Yes, I've read the study.
Great. In fact, the American Psychological Association reports that, quote, family separation is on par with beating and torture in terms of its relationship to mental health. Are you aware of that?
I'm familiar with this information. Thank you.
Okay. The truth is, sir, that family separation does irreparable damage to children while doing nothing for our national security. It's immoral, it's un-American, and it's just plain wrong. And I am glad to hear you say that it's not happening, sir. But I went to the border last month, and I was truly shocked by the conditions that I saw there. Medical care was inconsistent at best, and the accommodations were inadequate. Just last week, we saw new photos of detained children sleeping outside on the dirt at a Border Patrol station in McAllen, Texas. And on Monday, we learned that a fifth migrant child died in custody since family separation began. These stories are appalling, and yet they keep happening. Now, Congress just provided $500 million in February to address the humanitarian crisis at the border, and will soon provide more. Why do these tragedies keep happening?
So they're happening because the crisis is exceeding the resources provided. That's why we've asked for more, and we've asked for more authority to deal with it, to prevent this crisis from happening in the first place and from the children being put at risk. We've deployed the funding from FY19 that Congress has authorized. We've increased our temporary facilities by 500 beds in Donna, by 500 in El Paso. We've got 3 additional soft-sided facilities coming online in June. We've deployed medical practitioners. We now have over 100 certified medical practitioners in our 2 busiest sectors.
Right, but
we've asked for more money to extend that.
People keep dying, and so this is obviously more than a question of resources. Congress has been more than willing to provide the resources and work with you to address the security and humanitarian concerns, but at this point, with 5 kids that have died, 5,000 separated from their families, I feel like, and the evidence is really clear, that this is intentional. It's intentional. It's a policy choice being made on purpose by this administration, and it's cruel and inhumane. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
That's an appalling accusation, and our men and women fight hard to protect people in our custody every single day. We've asked for this resources 3 weeks ago. It hasn't been responded to by Congress, and we've asked for changes in authorities for the last 3 years that would have prevented this from happening.
Mr. Chairman, I should be recognized.
Gentlelady's time has expired. Gentlemen, acts to be recognized.
I make a motion that the lady's words be taken down.
Motion dies for lack of a second. It's already died. Gentleman from New York, mm-hmm. Recognized for 5 minutes, Mr. Katko.
I'm sorry. Wait a minute. I want to pause you. You didn't call for a second. There's no room.
Yes. Well, counsel had asked me to ask Ms. Underwood to clarify her statement for the record.
I will be happy to, Mr. Chairman. I said that this is more than a question of resources. Congress has been more than willing to provide resources and to work with you, Mr. Secretary, to address these security and humanitarian concerns. And at this point, with 5 children dead and 5,000 separated from their families, this is intentional. It's a policy choice being made on purpose by this administration, and it's cruel and inhumane. I yield back.
And Mr. Chairman, you cannot impugn the character of the witness by in stating that he intentionally murders children. That is completely inappropriate, and her words should be taken down. She was very explicit.
Well, and I asked her to rephrase it. She just did.
She restated it.
I restated. I did not say murder. I said 5 children have died as a result of a policy choice that he has
said.
Said
it was intentional.
Excuse me, sir. That I'm is still murder. Talking. He has said that he stands by the policy decisions of this administration. That's what he said at the beginning of his testimony. And he says he stands by the budget request. This is a policy choice.
And he has said the policy is they stopped those detentions. They don't do it in those separations. He's made that clear repeatedly. You refuse to listen to him. That's not the point. You said he intentionally supported policies that caused the death of children. That is wrong. Your words need to be taken down, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Ranking Member, this happened this week. Yesterday, another child died under his leadership.
Because we can't get the resources to help them. That's what he's here trying to get, is the money to stop this.
Well, Chair, we'll call for a vote. I will not take the vote to take down the words. We'll ask. Well, thank you very much. The chair rules that is the language is appropriate and that it should not be taken down.
I could record a vote on that.
Request for a recorded vote has been called. We'll ask the clerk to call a roll.
Ms. Jackson Lee. Ms. Jackson Lee. Mr. Langevin. No. Mr. Langevin votes no. Mr. Richmond. Mr. Payne. Ms. Rice. Ms. Rice votes no. Mr. Correa.
Hold on, we need to make sure that people understand the vote. The vote is sustaining Ms. Underwood's. Let me read the language.
I thought it was a motion to appeal the ruling of the chair.
According to the chair, the committee stands in recess, subject to call the chair. In the interest of, for what purpose does the gentleman seek recognition?
Mr. Chairman, I appeal the ruling of the chair.
The gentleman from Alabama moves to appeal the ruling of the chair. The question now appears, shall the ruling of the chair stand and the ruling of the committee? Those in favor of opposing the chair's opinion, vote aye. Those opposed, vote nay. Clerk will call the roll.
Ms. Jackson Lee. Ms. Jackson Lee. Mr. Langevin. Mr. Langevin votes no. Mr. Richmond. Mr. Richmond. Mr. Payne. Mr. Payne. Ms. Rice. Ms. Rice votes no. Mr. Correa. Mr. Correa. Ms. Torrey Small. Ms. Torrey Small. Mr. Rose. Mr. Rose votes no. Ms. Underwood. Ms. Underwood votes no. Ms. Slotkin. Ms. Slotkin. Mr. Cleaver. Mr. Cleaver. Mr. Green of Texas. Mr. Green of Texas.
Yes.
Ms. Clark. Ms. Clark. Ms. Titus. Ms. Titus votes no. Mrs. Watson Coleman. Mrs. Watson Coleman. Ms. Berrigan. Ms. Berrigan votes no. Mrs. Demings. Mrs. Demings. Mr. Rogers.
Yes.
Mr. Rogers votes yes. Mr. King. Mr. King. Mr. McCall. Mr. McCall. Mr. Katko.
Yes.
Mr. Katko votes yes. Mr. Ratcliffe.
Yes.
Mr. Ratcliffe votes yes. Mr. Walker. Mr. Walker. Mr. Higgins. Mr. Higgins. Mrs. Lesko. Mrs. Lesko. Mr. Green of Tennessee.
Yes.
Mr. Green of Tennessee votes yes.
You want to be a
Mr. Taylor.
Yes.
Mr. Taylor votes yes. Mr. Joyce. Mr. Joyce. Mr. Crenshaw.
Yes.
Mr. Crenshaw votes yes. Mr. Guest.
Yes.
Mr. Guest votes yes.
What?
Ms. Jackson Lee. Mr. Richmond. Mr. Payne. Mr. Correa. Ms. Torrey Small. Ms. Slotkin.
Yes.
Ms. Slotkin votes yes. Mr. Cleaver. Mr. Green of Texas. Ms. Clark. Mrs. Watson Coleman. Mrs. Demings. Mr. King.
Yes.
Mr. King votes yes. Mr. McCall. Mr. Walker. Mr. Higgins. Mrs. Lesko. Mr. Joyce.
How am I recorded?
The chairman is not recorded.
No.
The chair, Mr. Thompson votes no.
Mr. Chairman, over here. Parliamentary inquiry, so rule 27, section 4 of the House rules, a member cannot vote on something that they have a direct, that directly impacts them. And with great respect to my colleague from Illinois, I believe this vote is directly about her. So I think respectfully, she should withdraw her vote to be compliant with rule 26, section 4 of the House rules. 27, excuse me.
Not a valid point.
All right.
Clerk will announce the vote.
This vote, there are 9 yeas and 7 noes.
The words will be taken down. Chair recognizes the gentleman from New York, Mr. Katko.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before I ask my question, I just want to note a personal observation. I was a federal prosecutor down on the El Paso border for years. I interacted with agents on a regular basis. These agents were shot at. These agents were assaulted. These agents dedicate and risk their lives every moment of every day to try and keep this country safe. I don't think anyone is intentionally trying to commit harm to anyone down there. And I just hope that moving forward, this committee is reminded of the long and storied history of bipartisanship and trying to get the job done and trying to keep our country safe instead of making personal things that are unfortunate. So with that, I just want to refocus our attention, Mr. McAleenan, on a different part of the budget, a part of the budget I think is critically important that is often overlooked, or I don't know if overlooked is the right word, but not as prioritized as some of the other issues of today, and that is cybersecurity. As ranking member of the Cybersecurity Subcommittee, I see every day the vulnerabilities that our country faces in the cyber realm. And just yesterday or the day before, I visited the CISA section and in general, and the HURT teams and the National Cybersecurity and Technical Services area. And I was overwhelmingly impressed by their ability to get the things done. They get done with the little resources that they have. So if you could, Mr. McAleenan, could you tell us what priority the cybersecurity is within the budget and whether the resources requested are adequate to getting the job done? And I also, when we finish with that, if you don't touch on yourself, I do want to talk about the cyber workforce issue and whether or not we are sufficiently addressing the needs of the cyber workforce.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to talk about both of those, and I would, if appropriate, also appreciate the opportunity to outline all the steps we've taken to provide increased medical care for children in our custody, but focusing
Please
on
do.
Cyber first.
Okay.
The $1.3 billion request for the cybersecurity and infrastructure security agency is a significant request for the first time. It includes $20 million directed to election security, the Protect 2020 initiative. We appreciate your visit and support of our men and women in this area. I have tremendous confidence in the leadership of CISA with Chris Krebs, their strategy both for election 2020, but also securing the .gov infrastructure, and for bringing on additional cybersecurity professionals. The additional authority, the ability to provide salaries that are more competitive, not quite what they can make in the private sector, but commensurate with the mission, plus some additional funding will allow us to compete for cybersecurity talent. And we have a good strategy to go out and find and bring those people on board swiftly. In engaging with private sector entities that are critical partners on the financial infrastructure, for instance, I'm hearing a lot of very good things about what CIS is doing, about our strategy, and I intend to amplify that and support it as acting secretary. It's an area that I'm learning a lot about.
I commend the chairman and my colleague, Cedric, for highlighting this issue in the hearing yesterday, and we're going to continue to do that. Now, if there's something you want to clarify from your last round of questions, please do so.
Thank you. I would just note that as we started to see more children come into our custody, both with families and children, last July, we began to divert operational resources to address medical care of children. I directed that through Border Patrol funding. In July, I requested a Homeland Security Advisory Council subcommittee highlight these issues and advise us on family and child care in our custody. They've completed an emergency report on April 19th that I commend to this committee with a number of recommendations for both resources and support and care requests. In December, when we had the first and second deaths of a child in our process for the first time in over a decade, we aggressively ramped up our medical care without the funding. I went ahead and authorized additional contracting, additional facilities without the funding even there. In January, we requested $800 million in humanitarian aid as part of the budget package. We got a little bit over half of that. We requested $1.1 billion 3 weeks ago. We've requested Coast Guard medical teams who have responded and are on site with us at the border. We have the Public Health Service Commission Corps providing medical care at the border. We have hundreds of medical care professionals that were never in Border Patrol stations there now because of actions we've taken to try to protect children in our custody. I'm proud of that record. We're working hard to address it. But this crisis exists because of our legal framework, because we're inviting the kids to make this.
Yeah, I'm going to interrupt. I don't have too much little time, and I just want to make sure I get this point clear. Is it fair to say that if we increase budget resources for the border area, we can increase even more your effort to try and keep these children safe and healthy? But it's overwhelming how many people are coming in. It's fair to say more money would definitely help the issue?
More money would definitely help, but a change in the authorities would help even more.
Thank you very much. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Chair recognizes the young lady from Las Vegas, Ms. Titus, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, I just would like to follow up with a question about Puerto Rico because my numbers aren't exactly the same as the President's. It's my understanding that roughly $11 million has been spent and $41 billion has been allocated for recovery in Puerto Rico. That's a lot different from the $91 billion that's been tweeted by the President. So I don't know if you can confirm those numbers or dispute them or can get back to us.
We can get back to you on the numbers.
All right, I hope so, because there's a big difference in our numbers and the $91 billion. I also share the concerns of Mr. King about the anti-terrorism component of DHS. You want $5 billion to build a wall to kind of keep out sick children, I guess, and yet at the same time you're cutting $213 million from the UASI grants. Las Vegas welcomes over 40 million tourists a year. We had the worst shooting in modern history there. We need those UASI grants to complement what we do at the local level to fight terrorism. I wonder how you justify that you can keep up with that component of your mission while cutting the funding.
So obviously the grants and our partnership with state and locals are critical to the Homeland Security enterprise writ large. And in talking with our team that oversees the grants at FEMA, my understanding is the $50 billion we've deployed over the last decade plus has dramatically increased capacity across the board for state and locals, and that we're looking for shared responsibility, shared investments with communities around the country to maintain their capability while we still have significant funding dedicated through UASI grants. If there are specific areas of concern, I'm happy to look at that, to talk it through with the FEMA team and understand the levels that we're applying. But this is my understanding from looking at the budget with them and hearing their recommendations.
Well, I hope you'll talk with our sheriff from Las Vegas because they're concerned that their diffusion center that brings in all the first responders, that not only are you cutting their funds, but you're now requiring a local match, and that'll put a serious burden, I think, on our capabilities in Las Vegas.
Understand the concern. We're happy to continue that conversation.
Another question that's kind of not in keeping with what's been going on here, but I think it's important because of the state I represent, is a recent directive that y'all issued from your department that would block legal residents from working in the legal cannabis industry. Now, a number of states have legalized marijuana in one form or another. It's over half the states, and they're moving in this direction. And you've said that an applicant who is involved in certain marijuana-related activities may lack good moral character. Well, if we use that term, there may be some people involved in legal political activities that lack good moral character based on some of our judgment. But I just wonder why you've come to that conclusion. It's a legal business at the state level. It's a highly regulated business. And because it's so security concerned, I think there's much more scrutiny of people who work in this industry than in any other besides gaming that I can think of in Nevada. How did y'all come to that decision?
I'm actually not familiar with that decision process, but I can certainly look into it and get back to you. Obviously, there's a difference of viewpoint in the enforcement of marijuana laws between the federal and some of the emerging state jurisdictions, but it's something that I'll look at.
Thank you. I'll ask you one other question. There's a tremendous backlog that we hear about with access to citizenship visas, work visas, family visas, humanitarian visas, all kind of relief. I think you have a backlog of 2.3 million cases last year. We've not seen this kind of backlog since right after 9/11 when the new security measures were put in place. Yet you want to transfer $207 million. Again, you have an obligation to do something and you're cutting your request for funding while telling this committee you need more resources to deal with the crisis. Clearly, citizenship and visas are part of that crisis. Can you tell us how you justify that or what your plans are for getting rid of this backlog?
So not familiar with the specific cut you're referencing, Congresswoman, but I can tell you that CIS does have a backlog, but is working very hard on its processing. They naturalized more people last year than any year prior. It's a record level of efforts in their naturalization. We are working on immigrant visas across the board, on the H-1B, H-2A program. So I know we have a growing backlog in asylum cases, which is driven by this flow at the border. But I think they're working very hard as a fee-funded agency to keep up with the rest of the naturalization process, et cetera.
It is fee-funded. In fact, it's $700, which is very expensive. Many people can't afford that fee who would like to move into different channels, get different visas, perhaps get citizenship. So with that kind of fee and this kind of cut, I'm not sure that you're kind of balancing priorities there or how the resources will work best.
I know the fees are assigned based on the cost for administering each program and each application. I'll take a look at the cut issue that you're referencing.
I appreciate that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Ratliff.
Thank you, Chairman. Mr. Acting Secretary, thank you for being here and testifying on the President's FY20 budget request for DHS. As you know, President Trump has set an agenda that I believe does prioritize the safety and security of the American people, an agenda that includes a robust border security operation, strong cybersecurity protections, both for our networks and for our critical infrastructure, and a comprehensive strategy to prevent potential terrorists from ever setting foot on American soil. But as you have already talked about today, unfortunately, we are facing a dire humanitarian and security crisis at our southern border. Border agents in my home state of Texas have provided statistics that I just saw yesterday indicating that they're averaging 229 migrant apprehensions per hour, or 5,500 per day, more than 38,000 per week, and on pace this month to eclipse more than 150,000 illegal migrant apprehensions. Obviously, one of the main reasons, as you have talked about, for this incredible surge in terms of numbers are our asylum laws. Our asylum laws that have put your department in a bind because your folks can't deliver legal consequences to many of the illegal migrants that are apprehended at the border because they're either minors or they are with family units that have arrived with minors. And because of the legal precedent set forth under the Flores settlement, because that precedent under Flores says that unaccompanied minors and members of a family unit from non-contiguous countries have to be released in the United States after 20 days to await immigration proceedings. We've talked about that problem. And I realize that one solution to that problem is for Congress to address it. Congress absolutely can do that, absolutely should do that, and I'm here to tell you that I don't think Congress will do that. I say that because some, not all, of my colleagues on the other side like the problem better than they like the solution. They like to stand up before the American people and say that this president and this administration are separating children from their families because of inhumane reasons, rather than honestly telling them that they're doing so because under the Flores settlement, the law requires that you either separate the children or release the entire family in total disregard for immigration laws as Congress passed them. So I'm not waiting on a solution from Congress anytime soon. My question for you, Mr. Secretary, is the other possibility is for DHS to address it administratively. Last fall, DHS and HHS proposed new regulations that would effectively terminate the Flores settlement agreement and replace it with formal regulations governing the apprehension, processing, care, custody, and release of minor children. What's the status of those regulations?
Thank you for asking about that aspect, and we're aggressively working on finalizing the Flores rule. What it would do is codify the key elements of that settlement for over 20 years ago in terms of the care of children in federal custody, but it would also allow us to maintain custody of families together pending their immigration proceedings. We got over 100,000 comments on that rule. They have to be responded to issue a final rule. That's going to be coming up in the coming weeks and months. It's going to be released and will hopefully allow us to address that part of this issue.
So what you're telling me, Mr. Secretary, is that notwithstanding Congress not willing to act on this issue, the Department of Homeland Security is attempting to address this crisis at the border through these proposed regulations.
That is one of the many dynamic actions we're taking to try to address this crisis, yes.
Thank you. Another problem that we need to address, or part of what relates to this issue, is the low threshold screening standards for migrants to claim asylum. If a migrant successfully asserts credible fear, there is a good chance they're likely going to remain in the United States. And so accordingly, what your folks are seeing, I know, are asylum applicants who are very well coached by coyotes and by immigration advocates and others. My question to you is, does this budget provide appropriate funding to ensure that DHS is conducting regular fraud risk assessments as it relates to affirmative asylum application process? And generally, can you address what DHS is trying to do to combat asylum fraud and abuse?
Thank you for those two questions, Congressman. You've highlighted one of the key drivers of this crisis. It's the gap between the initial credible fear standard in the asylum proceeding and the ultimate asylum standard adjudicated by an immigration judge. What we're seeing is 85 to 90% of people meeting that initial bar, a possibility of proving an asylum case, and only 10 to 15% of Central Americans meeting the actual asylum standard at the end of an immigration proceeding. That allows people to remain in the U.S. indefinitely, pending an immigration proceeding, and creates a significant pull factor that we're grappling with. You asked how we're addressing that with fraud prevention. First of all, since I became acting secretary, we've deployed over 100 HSI agents to the border with forensic interview skills to talk to families crossing the border to identify whether there's a family relationship first and foremost. So these are targeted based on concerns of fraud to begin with, and then to look at whether what they're presenting to border agents is accurate. So that's first and foremost. Secondly, we have a fraud detection and national security unit at CIS. That we now have directed them to really engage on the asylum piece of this and to make sure we're following through effectively. And ideally, we need to get proceedings completed. That's the central problem we have right now, is we're not getting results from immigration courts that can be effectuated because people are not in custody. And that means that ICE is left to go out into communities to pick people up when it could be much more efficiently done as they arrive at the border. Thank you for asking that question and allowing us to talk more about the problem.
I appreciate your response, Mr. Secretary. My time's expired. I yield back.
Gentleman's time.
First, let me start by correcting the record. The separation of children and families didn't happen because it was required. That is not why the president did it. This administration is on record in saying they did this to deter people from coming. And so to knowingly separate children and families by prosecuting parents that was going to result in the separation and then mentally harm children, that's despicable. And that is why people believe that what this administration is doing is intentional. It's a belief based on all the lies that members of Congress have been told, all the lies that have been out in the public, and from what has been going out into the public. Let me start. Mr. Secretary, is there a written policy on the Remain in Mexico policy?
There's a statutory provision. There is
that policy in writing?
Yes.
Can you provide us that copy?
I believe we already have provided it to Congress, but
if you could give it to me, that would be fantastic.
Mr. Chairman, just provide the copy of the policy. That's all she asked him for.
Okay, thank you.
So, Mr. Secretary, you are familiar with that policy, correct?
I am.
And under that policy, there are certain groups of people that are not eligible to be returned to Mexico. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay, and under that group, unaccompanied minors, one of them?
Correct.
Cubans?
Correct.
Mexicans?
Correct.
Vulnerable people?
Correct.
Sick, elderly?
That's discretionary, but those are categories to be considered.
LGBT?
Discretionary, but categories to be considered.
Pregnant women?
Same.
Okay, let me tell you, Mr. Secretary, I either was lied to at the border or something has changed. When I was at the border in April, I specifically spoke to Officer Blanchard with Border Patrol. He told me he was from D.C., and he told me he wrote this policy. And he told me that pregnant women were excluded and not to be sent at the border. You come in and you talk about how you want to help protect children and they're going through this dangerous journey and keeping them safe. Well, guess what? This administration is putting pregnant women in danger. Do you know how dangerous it is to be sent to Juarez, Mexico? Do you?
I'm familiar with Juarez, Mexico, and what the government.
Well, let me tell you, Mr. Secretary, as a member of Congress, this is how dangerous it is. I can't go there without getting permission. That's how dangerous it is. Then, if you go to the State Department's website, and we got a little copy of it here for you, it says Mexico, violent crimes such as homicide, kidnapping, carjacking. Oh, but then if you go to the State Department's specific website on Juarez, it asks you to reconsider your travel. So it is so dangerous to travel to Juarez that the State Department is telling people to reconsider travel because of violent crime and gang activities are widespread. U.S. government employees, and I quote, are required to retain prior approval to even go into the downtown area. But this is where you're sending pregnant women back into Mexico while they await their asylum. Do you realize that this is happening?
So the migrant protection protocol.
Do you realize that pregnant women are being sent back to dangerous parts of countries that our own country tells people not to go to reconsider their travel?
So
do you realize that's happening? That's a yes or no.
So we, under the migrant protection protocols, we are asking people to wait in Mexico for their immigration hearing.
Okay, so you, I'm going to reclaim my time because this is what the American people need to know. A, I was lied to at the border, and this is why there is no credibility with this administration. That is why there's no credibility. All right, let me move on for a moment. The 72-hour rule. Are you familiar with the 72-hour rule?
Which one?
Well, the one that basically says that within 72 hours, children need to be, they need to be processed and turned over.
You're talking about the Trafficking Victims Protection Reauthorization Act rule for unaccompanied children?
There's, yes, the 72-hour rule, sir. Do you know how disturbing it is when the largest law enforcement agency in this country is not even following the law?
Well,
it's disturbing. You're not following the 72-hour rule, as we know, because you just had a 16-year-old child die that was being held for a week. People are being turned away at the border when they present themselves at the ports of entry. How do I know? I've been there. You have agents who are treating people like animals and in person telling them how terrible they are. How do I know? I've been there firsthand. We just saw the text messages. And an agent then hits a migrant? Is this how to be treating people who are escaping violence? Of course not. So why do people think this administration is intentionally harming children? Well, let's just look at the facts. Look at all the lies. Look at the harm done to children and their mental health. Look at the children that are dying under your watch. And you just said, Mr. Secretary, you are proud of your record. That is despicable to say. You should not be proud of a record of having five children die under your watch. I yield back.
Chairman, could I respond to any of that last segment?
I think that lady made her own statement. Chair recognizes the gentlelady from Arizona, Ms. Lesko.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, Mr. Secretary, for being here. I have 5 minutes, but I'll yield you some time to respond to what Ms. Berrigan said.
The one important part of what that last segment was that the 72-hour rule, where we try to transfer children to HHS custody within 3 days of their arrival, that's a critical protection for children. That's why this administration has asked for $3 billion additional dollars for HHS to provide additional bed space so that we can transfer unaccompanied children in a timely fashion. That's a critical part of our supplemental request, and we would appreciate if Congress would consider it.
Thank you. And members, I'm from a border state, from Arizona. I've been to the border. I've also been to a facility where they shelter unaccompanied children. I know that there is a crisis. Everybody in Arizona, everybody in the nation, it seems like, knows there's a crisis at the border. And it's not only to our security, but it is a humanitarian crisis. When I had the previous secretary here, she said girls as young as 11 years old were getting pregnancy tests because of what the cartels do and what happens on this long journey. And instead of blaming the United States, when I've seen these Border Patrol agents help these children, they go out of their way to help children, help families. They are good people. Wouldn't you say that it is actually the cartels that are encouraging these people to travel thousands of miles to exploit our loose immigration laws and asylum laws and are charging them, what, $6,000 a child? Wouldn't you say we should place the blame on them instead?
Absolutely agree, Congresswoman. It's a $3 billion industry now for the most violent criminal organizations in our hemisphere. They're exploiting vulnerable people from Central America to our border, and it's unacceptable.
And I agree, Mr. Chairman and members, it is totally unacceptable. And that is why I am so supportive and appreciate everything the president has done to try to mitigate this crisis, not only a security crisis to our nation, but also a humanitarian crisis for the migrants themselves. I mean, he has tried every which way to do what he can, and I appreciate that so much. And that's why I will support this extra funding, because it's very obvious to me that it's needed. It's needed to help these migrants, to help with the security. We also need to pass good immigration laws. And so last year, I co-sponsored and voted for what I thought was a compromise, that we could actually get something done. And that was, we not only, you know, had a bill that would have helped secure the border, it would have changed some of our asylum laws, but it also would have given DACA recipients legal status. I just came from Judiciary Committee. They're trying to push through a bill, the DREAMER Act bill. But unfortunately, in that bill, it has no age limits. It allows people that have crimes, it allows people that fraudulently fill out their application to be here. And so, to me, that's a big concern. I want to switch, because I only have a minute, 24 seconds left. And that is on a committee hearing we had yesterday. It's a subcommittee hearing, and there was concern by a number of members that DHS employees were being diverted to the border on a voluntary basis to help with the crisis at our border. And so I was told by staff today, just so that we correct what happened yesterday with some of the words, is that no TSO officers, no transportation security officers that are on the front line of our airports are actually being diverted or deployed to the border right now. And so I guess my question is, would this money that you're asking for actually help so that we don't have to divert people from other security details to the border?
It would. It would help us with our partnership with DOD. It would help us with our law enforcement surge assets that are going to the border, including TSA Federal Air Marshals that are part of our Viper teams that are mobile in the first place and that have deployed to the border to help us. But it will also support volunteers from across the department. Just like we respond to a natural disaster or storm, we've asked for volunteers to come help us care for people in our custody, let our agents get back to our border security mission, help them process more efficiently. One thing I didn't get to explain on the medical side is that every day we're taking 65 people to the hospital. That means we have agents and officers on hospital watch duty 24/7 all across that border. About 10 of those a day are admitted to the hospital and receive tremendous medical care from border communities that are stressed by this situation as well. So any additional support from volunteers will help, and being able to fund that support will help us manage the crisis. I'd still like to focus on addressing it and preventing it, starting in Central America. But yes, we need help to manage it, and that's the funding request we've made.
Thank you, and I just want to add that I do greatly appreciate the Border Patrol officers, all of our law enforcement officers and DHS. The ones that I have met are really working hard to protect our nation and to help these migrants. So thank you. I yield back my time.
Thank you. Mr. Secretary, in your meeting with the ranking member and myself yesterday, you told us that TSOs were being deployed to the border.
That's why I added that while they haven't yet been deployed, we have requested volunteers that could include TSOs to help deploy and support the mission on the border.
So they will be.
That's a potential, Mr. Chairman, yes.
Chair recognizes the gentleman from New York, Mr. Rose.
Mr. Secretary, thank you for being here today, and thank you for your service to this country across multiple administrations. I do believe in your heart you want to put the country first. So I want to first of all talk about fentanyl. It's coming from China, and it's killing kids in virtually all of our districts. China's the largest producer of illicit fentanyl. Recently, there's been a bipartisan bill, bicameral as well, that called the Fentanyl Sanctions Act, proposed to hold China's feet to the fire. And part and parcel of this is the establishment of a federal commission which will focus on developing a consensus and a strategic approach to address illicit fentanyl. Very basic question, would you be a supporter of Homeland Security participating on the commission and in this whole of government approach to address fentanyl?
So addressing the scourge of fentanyl is one of the department's top priorities on the counter-narcotics side. And so I'd certainly like to talk with you about that and see how we could be a participant in that effort.
Do you have any other updates you'd like to give on your perception of the fentanyl issue right now?
I've got maybe three or four. I'll try to do it quickly because I know you have limited time. Mm-hmm. First of all, the investments in 2019 that will allow us to transform how we do scanning of trucks and vehicles crossing our southern border will make a huge impact in our ability to detect synthetic opioids like fentanyl and all narcotics. Yeah. We're also deploying this equipment in mail facilities and express consignment out at the JFK mail facility, for instance, where most of the fentanyl that's in mail packages and hiding in that huge mass of consumer goods that's coming across from China. We're able to detect that better with that equipment. We're also working with U.S. Postal Inspection Service and HSI to take targeted shipments that we find with 25 grams of fentanyl and follow that into where the pill presses are and the distributors. We've had a lot of successes this last year, more than doubled our fentanyl seizures at our mail facility. So it's a tremendous operational priority for us, both in interdiction and investigation. And the technology investments we received in 19 are going to make a huge impact.
Thank you. So moving on to counterterrorism, I represent a district in New York City, number one terrorist threat. The country, definitely, potentially the world at large. It's been raised already here that you and the administration with your support, has proposed pretty significant cuts to whether it's UASI, transportation security, so on and so forth, $587 million in cuts in total for Homeland Security grants to places that need them for counterterror spending, New York City particularly. You used a term that I found interesting earlier, shared responsibility. Your belief, correct me if I'm wrong, is that municipalities and states need to start doing more. Is that correct? So are you of the opinion that then the NYPD is not doing enough right now, is not shouldering the burden enough right now? Because these cuts are significant. I believe these cuts, it's not a scalpel, this is a hatchet. And I have to figure out what to say to them.
Right.
And it being from a bipartisan, country-first perspective, what do I tell them?
Well, first of all, you can tell Commissioner O'Neill that he's among our top partners in law enforcement all over the country and that NYPD is the most effective counterterrorism force in a state and local police level that I'm aware of. So please don't suggest that they're not doing enough. In terms of grant investments at a municipal level, especially our major cities that could be targets, that does have to be a shared federal, state, and local responsibility.
But monetarily, you're saying that they need to do more. New York City, New York State, other major urban areas that are the primary threats to counterterror, you're saying that they are not doing enough right now.
No, I'm saying that to sustain funding at the prior grant levels, and remember, we're working within a top-line budget. Nobody wants to make cuts to security programs ever. You're trying to balance across all of your requirements as a department and as an administration when you submit the budget. So I just want to emphasize that.
And is it a correct reading, then, of the budget to say that you have deemed the border a greater priority than counterterror right now?
So I think there are multiple priorities. The border is a significant priority.
You're increasing funding for one.
Correct.
And decreasing funding for the other.
Correct.
Yeah. Logical conclusion from that is that the border is a greater threat to this country right now than terrorism.
So Not necessarily, but you just noted the fentanyl risks, right? Mm-hmm. That's coming across the southern border. That's the primary
ports of entry, yes.
And it's having impact on our communities every single day. Mm-hmm. So it's a balance between all of those efforts. I think the idea on the grants is that the accumulated investments have gotten us to a place of significant security, especially in major cities. We need to continue to work on it, continue to partner, and hopefully we can manage through the cuts.
Okay, thank you for your time, Mr. Secretary, again, and thank you for your service.
Chair recognizes gentleman from Tennessee, Mr. Green.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ranking Member, Secretary McLennan, I've got to start off first by telling you thank you for your honorable service to this country. You have been a staunch defender of our freedoms and the rule of law, defending the Constitution as you swore an oath to do so almost 18 years ago. It is my understanding that you left what promised to be a high-paying civilian sector job after you felt inspired by the attacks at 9/11 to help CBP set up the Office of Anti-Terrorism. Your faithful service is very appreciated, and I hope we in Congress can do our job and provide you the funding you need and as requested by your people on the ground to continue your now broader mission. The Democrats got it flat wrong. While the president sounded the alarm on the crisis at the southern border, the left refused, in fact, shut the government down, stating, and I quote the speaker, a manufactured crisis, end quote. Now even the liberal New York Times is saying it is a crisis. Further, the deception of the left seems to know no bounds. The images of children in cages were actually from the Obama administration. Yet multiple activist legislators today have decried the separation of children when in fact this president stopped it. I'm highly concerned about my colleagues on the other side of the aisle using politics to block DHS from doing its job and securing our southern border. From demanding a limit on detention space for illegal aliens to the new supposedly cool thing to do, chanting, abolish ICE, abolish ICE. The Democrat Party has hit a new low on the rule of law. This country welcomes immigrants who come here legally with open arms, but a country without borders is not a country. And the notion that we should not be allowed to preserve our borders' very existence or even remove current barriers, as others have proposed, is ridiculous. My colleagues claim to be a party that defends federal workers, but where are they now defending our brave ICE agents? Where are they in helping those who serve us? Mr. Secretary, one quick question. Can you elaborate on the need for more beds for ICE and what the lack of such funding will do in disrupting ICE's mission?
So what we're seeing with the flows at the border, the one demographic that we can actually finish the enforcement of immigration law on and determine if someone has a right to stay in the U.S., a valid asylum claim, or should be repatriated is for single adults. Due to this border surge, we are exceeding ICE capacity for single adult beds, and we've requested more funding for it. Without that funding, we have an impossible choice. We either lose control of our border entirely because we won't be able to enforce the law even against single adults, or we're going to have to release people that were picked up in the interior with criminal records, which is also unacceptable. So we need that funding from Congress to maintain our border security and to support the men and women of ICE. And just to clarify, 75% of ICE's intake comes from the border. They are focused on supporting the border security mission first and foremost. But to take away their ability to also pick up criminals in the interior and to keep threats out of our communities would be very unfortunate for our security as a country.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Is there anything else that, based on the testimony that's been given so far, that you'd like to take the remaining minute of my time and just share with the committee your thoughts?
Thank you for that opportunity, Congressman. A thought I would have on this, you raised this challenge of single adults, and I just want to also put it in the context of families. In my first two hearings, testifying as acting secretary, being responsible for oversight of ICE, what I heard from members is a lot of concern about ICE officers in communities making arrests. And what struck me there is what we're asking to do with families is actually keep them safely together in custody to finish a proceeding, but not release them to communities. until they have proven a right to stay in the U.S. So what the members are asking me is saying, you can't keep them in custody, and you can't come into our communities, even if they have a final order of removal from a judge. That doesn't make sense. In what area of law would we tell our men and women who enforce the law that you can't follow through on a judge's final order of removal? That's our responsibility.
Exactly.
So we either have to fix it on the front end, or we have to recognize that ICE is going to need to be in communities to maintain the integrity of the system.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Thank you, Chair.
Chair recognizes the gentleman from Rhode Island, Mr. Lanterman, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Ms. Chairman. And Mr. McLean, thank you very much for your testimony and your service. I'd like to start out on a cyber-related question. Last September, then-Secretary Nielsen testified before the Senate that, and I quote, cyber attacks now exceed the risk of physical attacks. And then in March, she testified before our committee that cybersecurity is one of, if not the highest threats that we face in the homeland. Do you agree with that assessment, yes or no?
Yes.
So are you aware of how many cybersecurity-related vacancies there are within the Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency?
Not as I sit here today, but that I know that hiring effort is a top priority for CISA.
Okay. For the record, Mr. Chairman, there are 361 cybersecurity vacancies at CISA as of April 30th. And that concerns me, obviously. Ms. McLean, I have an email here from the Deputy Director of CISA, Matthew Travis, from Friday, May 17th, with the subject line, call for DHS volunteer force participation, requesting CISA employees to, and I quote, give serious thought to volunteering at the southern border. And I ask unanimous consent, Mr. Chairman, that the email be included in the record.
Without objection.
Thank you. So are you aware of this email, and did you discuss this call for volunteers with anyone at CISA?
So I'm not aware of that email in particular, but I am aware of the call for volunteers to help address a border crisis, just as we would do in a natural disaster. Our expectation, though, is that CISA would make risk-based decisions on the types of professionals that they would free up for this kind of mission and balance against their day jobs and their current focus.
So are you aware of anyone in your staff or within the Office of Secretary who discussed this with CISA First?
I'd have to ask. I know the Acting Deputy Secretary has personally helped me with this volunteer call to make sure that we're supporting the men and women at the border as much as we can.
So my question is, if cybersecurity is such a high threat to the homeland, and if CISA already faces such a stark shortage of workers, do you think it's appropriate than for them to leave their jobs protecting our federal networks and critical infrastructure, including our elections, to go to the border?
I would not expect nor want the CISA leadership to deploy critical cybersecurity professionals in this role. If they have mission support professionals, attorneys, or others who could be spared to support this effort, we would welcome that. But that's for their management and leadership to handle.
I think it's important to have that on the record, because again, given the importance of the mission, the size of the threat, challenge that we face, the large number of vacancies within CISA, it's not, it seems to me, a department that can spare critical talent to go anywhere other than doing the job they're doing, protecting our federal networks. So, Mr. McLean, if I could, last week the President issued an executive order entitled Securing the Information and Communications Technology and Services Supply Chain, which found that potential supply chain risks constitute an unusual and extraordinary threat to the national security, foreign policy, and economy of the United States. The New York Times first reported on a leaked draft of this executive order in June 2018. Can you tell us, why did it take nearly a year for the President to sign the executive order?
So I'm not familiar with the process of developing that, but I know that this has been something that's been focused on by Department of Homeland Security experts, at risk to our supply chain of equipment that could be vulnerable to counterintelligence exploitation.
Do you believe that the national security of the United States should be subsumed to concerns over trade talks?
I think there's always a balance, but national security is essential. And I think very clearly the focus of this administration.
So portions of the executive order have already been put on hold due to unintended consequences of the bans put in place after its issuance. Do you anticipate further challenges implementing the executive order, which requires coordinating efforts with across several federal agencies in the absence of a White House cybersecurity coordinator?
So I'll look at that to see if there are any coordination issues. I have not been apprised of any by my team. I think it's been rolled out effectively, and we'll continue to monitor it.
I still am very concerned about the fact that the cybersecurity coordinator's position, the cybersecurity coordinator was fired and the position was eliminated at a time when this is one of our biggest challenges. I believe we need a coordinator to be fulfilling that role to bring our strategy together. But my time's expired. Thank you for your testimony.
If I could very briefly just note, I've already met with a director of national intelligence, the FBI director, the attorney general on cyber issues. It's going to be a critical priority for DHS to be aligned and coordinated across the interagency.
Thank you.
Thank you. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Taylor, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member. Mr. Secretary, I just wanted to focus in, if we could, for a second on the humanitarian crisis on the border. I know that there's been a lot of discussion about that. And you've mentioned, I think, briefly in your testimony, talking about the role of smugglers and coyotes and sort of driving that. Would you mind expanding on what's driving it in terms of not the migrants themselves, but the actors outside of them that are operating, obviously, in Mexico, that are creating this problem? Because clearly something's happening. Something is accelerating the kind of increase, the influx, and that's in turn creating the kind of crisis I think that you see a lot of concern about.
Yeah, and what's happening primarily and what we saw really starting early last year was increased awareness that there's a vulnerability in our legal system due to the reinterpretation of the Flores settlement, that if an adult arrives with a child, they have a likelihood of staying in the United States. And smugglers have capitalized on that. They're directly advertising that fact. You don't have to take it from me, even though we've done thousands of interviews of migrants coming across the border with their parents. Why did you come now? Why did you bring your child? Because the smugglers told me, now's the time to come, and if I have a child with me, they have to release me. That's what we hear repeatedly. But you can read that in the Washington Post, the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, all who have gone to the Western Highlands of Guatemala, the New Yorker, who have studied this issue, who have seen how smugglers are advertising almost at a retail level in communities. We have one department of Guatemala that has over 3% of their population has come to the U.S. in 7 months. The effort there to recruit and to fund the smuggling network is just absolutely dramatic. So that's the kind of challenge we're facing. And social media has made that communication easier and faster and even more challenging for law enforcement to deal with.
And so it seems to me that you're saying you need two things. You need some statutory fixes and you need some resources. And you say you've been asking for the statutory fixes for about 3 years now. Is that
ever since we lost the authority to detain families together, our law enforcement professionals at DHS have recommended that we get a statutory change. Yes.
Okay. And then, and one thing I didn't do, is there anything you want to respond to that you didn't have a chance to? I mean, is there a thought on your mind? I know I started to ask you questions, but.
Sure. I think this committee and the American people should be aware of the extent of the effort that law enforcement professionals who are not trained for this set of missions are undertaking to try to protect vulnerable people in this cycle. It is an immense effort every single day. I was just down on the border in El Paso a few weeks ago. We had a supervisor on detail from Washington State, big hulking guy, looked like an NFL linebacker. There he was on his knee making a baby formula in a bottle to hand to a migrant mother with a child. And that's not what he signed up for. He volunteered to come to the Southwest border, and he's there trying to keep people safe, to care for them in our custody. And I think the extent of that effort, how hard our agents are working, how pressed they are, and how much help they need is incredible. And they've been dealing with this for months on end without relief. I think that has to be recognized.
Sure. One statistic that is stuck with me in my short time here in Congress is that we admit 1 million people with permanent visas every year, a million new visas every year, and we admit another 10 million people on temporary visas every year. And I think we're the most generous nation on earth in terms of immigration. No other country lets that many people in
every year. So I think it's a point of pride for me that our country is so welcoming to immigrants. The extent of the people that, so you arrested 100,000 last month on the border. How many of those have been released into the United States?
So due to the restrictions on retaining families together, about 60% of those crossings are now family units. So almost all of those people have been released in the United States. If they're not from Mexico, if they didn't go through a credible fear finding and get a negative determination, they're likely to still be in the U.S. awaiting a court proceeding.
And so when you're doing your numbers, they're going into the temporary visa. So they're being apprehended and then being released on a temporary visa in the United States. Is that right?
It's not a visa. They're essentially paroled, released on their own recognizance to pending a court hearing.
Okay, so they're not in the 10 million bucket. They're another bucket altogether of people
Correct.
That are coming into this country illegally. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you. Chair, I recognize the young lady from New York, Ms. Rice, for five minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you, Mr. Acting Secretary, for being here today. We saw an unprecedented attack on our democracy from a foreign adversary in 2016. DHS is responsible for securing our critical infrastructure, including our elections. Do you agree with the intelligence community's 2017 assessment that Russia interfered in our presidential election to help then-candidate Donald Trump?
I accept the conclusions of our experts in the intelligence community.
Thank you. Has President Trump ever discussed the possibility of blocking entry into the U.S. southern border with you?
So, first of all, I'm not going to comment on conversations I've had or not had with the President of the United States. I think he's pretty clear on record about his priority for securing the southern border and the initiatives he's undertaking to do that, very publicly stating them, Oval Office addresses, and so forth.
Mr. McAleenan, the President said it to the American people, that he is thinking about shutting down the southern border. Did he ever directly speak with you about that? He spoke directly to the American people. I'm sure you can answer that question.
He did speak to the American people about it, and right. He also updated the American people that he was not looking at that as an immediate option, that
so did he
we're trying to
with
collaborate with Mexico to address a shared challenge from transnational criminal organizations.
Did he speak to you about it?
I'm not going to talk about conversations with the president.
Did he ever mention the possibility of a pardon if you violated the law and were arrested for closing the southern border, yes or no?
As I've noted, I'm not going to talk about conversations with the president, but I've never been asked to do anything illegal, and I'm on record in the media and elsewhere with that answer.
Well, have any people who've worked for you addressed concerns about being asked to do things that they felt were not legal and the personal ramifications they might suffer as a result of that? Has that ever bubbled up to your level?
So we would not ask our law enforcement professionals to violate the law. That's not acceptable for my level or for any of our leaders.
So Mr. Langevin asked you about CISA and your department's request for volunteers from different agencies throughout the federal government. CISA actually was not the only agency at DHS that you directed to ask for volunteers. Do you know the number of employees from TSA that have volunteered to go to the southern border?
I don't have that in front of me. I know that TSA has been one of our most responsive agencies in helping with crises or natural disasters for years.
There are some TSA employees who have volunteered?
Yes, certainly.
Okay, and how many of them, or have they been trained to work with migrant children and families?
So there will be training for anyone who's engaging directly with migrants
on arrival.
Has there
been for volunteers who are already there?
So any volunteer who's been deployed and is already on the border supporting CBP that will have received an orientation and training upon arrival.
So the training is going on?
Yes.
How many employees from the U.S. Secret Service have volunteered to go to the southern border?
I don't have that information as I sit here, but I can get it back to you.
Have any of them been trained to work with migrant children and families?
Again, that process would happen on arrival with a specific assignment in a sector, depending on the skills and expertise of the person going. It could be an attorney. We're not going to necessarily need to train them for migrant interaction. It could be a commercial driver's license holder just simply be driving.
I'm aware. So former Secretary Nielsen declared that cyber attacks now exceed the risk of physical attacks, and the Mueller report made clear the lengths the Russian government will go to meddle in our elections. So CISA, obviously, being the agency responsible for the cybersecurity of 99 federal agencies, I'm sure you would agree with me that this is not an ideal use of their time, even if it's on a voluntary basis.
So, again, if for critical personnel that are directly involved in protecting the election infrastructure, I do not expect them to be deployed as volunteers.
But you're not, you don't control who volunteers. If the general call is put out for volunteers, anyone can volunteer, right?
Respectfully, at the cabinet level, we don't do individual selections of whether volunteers can go. That's
yeah,
my expectation that our managers
you should be aware of what
appropriate assessment of
you should be aware of what your agency is asking people to do, because right. They have critical functions that they have to do in their own job description, and you've been given a lot of money from Congress to increase hiring and get people on board. So we don't have to deplete critical agencies at a critical time.
Yeah, we
do
will
you
not
agree with President Trump's decision?
Do you
agree with President Trump's decision to cut off aid to Central America at this critical juncture?
So I'm on record in multiple venues talking about the fact that to address this crisis effectively, we're going to need to increase security, governance, and address the push factors in Central America. So what my responsibility is, and I think what the president's looking for, is our accountable partners in Central America and targeted aid programs that can make a difference, that have a return on investment. And so working with Department of State, when we see those opportunities, I will be presenting those through my chain of command.
So you mentioned that you're traveling over the weekend?
I'm going on Monday, yes.
Okay, so, and I think the purpose of your trip is to discuss border security efforts.
I'm meeting with ministers from Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador in Guatemala City to talk about collaborations on addressing human trafficking and smuggling, yes.
Right. And how has that become more challenging with the president's directive to have, I believe, $500 million in aid cut off?
Well, it's frozen. It's not cut off. It's frozen. There are existing programs already ongoing. There are capabilities that these governments have, and there are partnerships on the ground that are ongoing. Again, the Attorney General was just there last week focusing on the anti-gang partnership that we have with these governments. So I'll be talking about ways that we can continue that momentum and the support we need, both from our capacity building, our professionals doing training, and any programs that are critical in that effort.
It's not just anti-gang. I mean, obviously, if there are very difficult situations in these countries, that sure. is the number one reason why people are coming here. And so
This is an economic migration. It's an opportunity gap in large part.
Okay, so I would just encourage you to continue to be vocal about how important it is that we continue our foreign aid to these countries so that we can begin to, you know, address this crisis that we all agree is happening at the border. And I thank you for your service. I yield back the balance of my time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Joyce.
Thank you for yielding, Mr. Chairman. And I thank you, Secretary McAleen, for appearing here today in front of us. Currently, there's a massive crisis at our southern border. Just last month's data of attempted illegal crossings represented the staggering 591% increase from just 2 years ago. Also driving this crisis is the makeup of the individuals who are crossing the border. Rather than adult males, who we saw in years past, family units and unaccompanied children are spiking, and our laws have not yet caught up. There's a surge of people who seek, and I emphasize to you, sir, the word seek, to be apprehended at the border, brought into custody, claim asylum, and be allowed to gain access to American jobs, healthcare, and education. This new group of families and unaccompanied minors arriving from Central America presents significant new challenges and must be addressed by this committee and the House. In the past, Democrats and Republicans would work together to address these issues, which are critical to the security of our country. Sadly, this has not been the case at all since January, when I was sworn in. The complete breakdown of bipartisan work in the face of the overwhelming scope and severity of this crisis has almost crippled DHS in carrying out your work. I am further concerned to hear you testify today that you expect the agency to exhaust funding before the end of the fiscal year if Congress does not act on your latest supplemental funding request. Now let me discuss my firsthand experience on this issue and how they relate to the question I'm about to ask you regarding an immediate measure to address this crisis while Congress works to get its act together. A few weeks ago at the southern border, I witnessed personally the lack of security in areas along the Colorado River that allows the cartels to smuggle drugs into our country, to smuggle drugs into South Central and Southwestern Pennsylvania, where I represent. During that visit, I also spoke with some CBP agents on the ground, and I was shocked by what was discussed. Currently, CBP is consistently being tasked with providing additional services, such as medical support, transportation services, leaving them unable to carry out their core missions of protecting and patrolling our southern border. The shortage of personnel is glaring, and one of the suggestions that the members of law enforcement made to me at this visit was that additional National Guard troops could be deployed to the border to help alleviate staffing issues. Do you believe that the presence of additional National Guard troops would be beneficial in curbing the crisis on the southern border? Is it time to address the immediate crisis and send additional National Guard troops to our southern border?
Thank you, Congressman, for first of all, you're going to the border and meeting with our men and women, but also for just accurately laying out the scope of the challenge we face. You know, six times last year in terms of the crossings, the change in demographics, the fact that 40% of our Border Patrol agents in top sectors of traffic are now dealing with care, custody, transportation, hospital watch for migrants. They're not on the border. They're not securing it against drugs coming across or against people that are trying to evade capture. That's a huge risk. It's a huge problem and a challenge that we're facing. So how can we address it? Well, first of all, I went to the border a week and a half ago with the Acting Secretary of Defense to look at this problem together, to talk about expanding our partnership in this area. And I can tell you that our National Guard partners have been absolutely essential in helping us maintain our border security mission over the last year and a half. Under Operation Guardian Support, we've got over 2,000 National Guard troops supporting us every day on that border, and opportunities to expand that footprint, working, for instance, with Governor Abbott in Texas, who's been a tremendous supporter of everything we're doing to help secure that border, is absolutely an option that we are considering, and we have stark needs in that regard. So I thank you for raising it and highlighting the key role our National Guard partners play in supporting our border security efforts.
Thank you, Secretary McAleen. Thank you for what you do for our country. I yield my remaining time.
Thank you, Chair. I recognize the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Green.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank the witness for appearing. Thank the ranking member as well for being a part of the hearing. Mr. Secretary, you have a plan to deal with the area immediately between the United States and Mexico that we call the border. And you have said that there's a humanitarian crisis that we have to address. My question to you is this: if we do not properly address the humanitarian crisis, assume that we do all of the things at the border that you'd like to see done in terms of keeping people out, what will happen to the people who are denied entry?
So,
what will happen to the people that we deny entry into the United States?
I think this is an important question, Congressman, to make sure we have clarity on what we're talking about, the border security versus the humanitarian aspects. The border security.
The border security, you've been very clear about how okay. You'd like to see that occur. I want to know about the people now who are not able to get into the United States because we have secured the border properly. What will happen to them?
Well, on the humanitarian side, even when we have an effective barrier, we do see people crossing and waiting. Okay,
let's assume for just a moment. Now, you're a lawyer. You have a JD.
I do.
So let's, you and I as lawyers, communicate appropriately. Let's now talk about the people. Let's not talk about those who get in. Let's talk about those who do not.
Right.
What will happen to them?
So they have an opportunity to present lawfully at ports of entry. And we're doing that in record numbers right now. We're headed toward almost 80,000 asylum seekers presenting at ports of entry this year. So that's first and foremost. Okay, we want to create opportunities to seek protection.
I don't mean to be rude, crude, and unrefined, but I'm interested in the people who do not get in. Here is my contention. You say we have a humanitarian crisis. Let us assume that the crisis is not resolved by virtue of persons having ingress into the country. Let's assume that it's not. If it's not resolved, what's going to happen in Central America? What's going to happen in Mexico? This is our hemisphere. These are our neighbors. Let's focus for just 1 minute, if you would, on what's going to happen to them. What will happen when they return home?
So first of all, I agree. These are our neighbors. This is our hemisphere, and we need to support and work with partners in Mexico and Central America to address
this. What do we do? What is going to happen to them, Mr. Secretary?
Right.
What's going to happen to them? So this is our hemisphere.
It is.
We give Jordan money to deal with Syrian refugees. We, through USAID, spend hundreds of millions of dollars in aid to help persons who are refugees. And we want to make sure that those refugees are taken care of. What will happen in Central America? What's going to happen? This is our neighbor, our neighborhood, if you will.
Right.
What will happen?
Well, there's been a lot of progress the last 5 years.
Thank you for the progress. But let's talk about the lack of progress, and we're sending people back to harm's way. These are people, but for the grace of God, could be you, could be me. We were just lucky to be born in the United States of America, just lucky. So what's going to happen to the people? What's going to happen when they go back to harm's way? You talk about the children coming here and the fact that they're impregnated and how they're abused along the way. Well, we're going to send them back. It's not as though they are going to somehow now become immune to all of the atrocities that they have to suffer and endure as they migrate in this direction. So what will happen to them?
What we want to do is give them a safe opportunity to apply for protections in the U.S. or
let's assume they don't make it to the U.S. This is our hemisphere.
Right. We'd like to do that in country, especially.
Yes, this is our hemisphere.
Right.
We have to do more to help people in our hemisphere. And I'm not saying that we cease and desist with our actions around the world. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying that we have to have enough heart to understand, and I believe you've said that this is a humanitarian crisis, that if it's a humanitarian crisis, a wall doesn't solve the humanitarian aspect of this crisis. It doesn't. More drones won't solve it. More Border Patrol agents won't solve it. People are still suffering in these countries that are in our neighborhood, our neighbors, Mr. Secretary. The question becomes, what do we do? This is your watch.
Right.
Now, you may not have the answer today. You're new on the job. But we will visit again, and we'll revisit the question. I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Chair. Yields 5 minutes to the gentleman from Mississippi, Mr. Guest.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, first, I would like to thank the men and women that you serve with for your professionalism, for your dedication, and your hard work under extremely difficult circumstances. I would like to apologize to you today for the inaction of the United States Congress. The administration, your predecessor, for the last year has been warning us of the looming crisis that exists along our southwest border. You testified earlier today that we had a security crisis, that we had a humanitarian crisis, as previously been testified, that we have a drug trafficking crisis, a human trafficking crisis, and an immigration crisis. I believe you used the words such as dire and unprecedented in explaining what we're seeing along the border. In March, I believe there was 103 illegal immigrants which were apprehended along our border, and then in April, that number rose to 109. And so instead of Congress helping you deal with the crisis, what we've seen today in this very hearing is a member of Congress make allegations that you and the men and women that you serve with have intentionally allowed children to die in your custody. And I want to apologize to you and the men and women that you serve with for these untrue remarks. My question to you, Mr. Secretary, is do you, as we sit today, do you currently have the personnel that you need to deal with this crisis?
No, we don't.
As we sit today, do you currently have the facilities that are needed to deal with the crisis along our southwest border?
No.
Mr. Secretary, do we currently have the number of immigration judges and court officials to manage the crisis along our border?
No, and we've asked for support in all those areas, Congressman.
And Mr. Secretary, let me ask you, have we as a Congress, have we approved the supplemental funding request to address the crisis along our border?
Not yet. We're eager to have that come forward.
And let me ask you another question, Mr. Secretary. Are our current immigration and asylum laws, are they making the crisis along our border better or worse?
Yeah, the fundamental driver is the pull factor. It's our immigration laws and the vulnerabilities for families, children, and for exploitation of our asylum process.
And so I would assume that your answer is that our current asylum laws are making the crisis worse. Is that correct?
Correct.
And so we as Congress, we have not provided you the resources you need for personnel. We've not provided you the facilities that we need. We've not provided you the court officials that you need. And our current, we've not approved the supplemental funding request that you've asked for. And the laws that Congress has in place today are currently making the situation along our southwest border worse instead of better. Is that correct?
That's all correct.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you. Chair recognizes the young lady from New York, Ms. Clark.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I thank you, Mr. Secretary, for appearing before us today. We know that the Department of Homeland Security has a very critical mission, protecting our nation. It seems, though, however, that we have not quite figured out the right blend and mix with respect to our mission and really focusing and honing in on it. The Department of Homeland Security is one of the youngest federal agencies in our nation, and that there is this level of contention about the mission of this agency is really, really distressing, particularly for a New Yorker who has lived through two terrorist attacks. We don't just need to defend ourselves against the all too real threats of cyber attacks, terrorism, and election interference. We also need to defend our values. And I think that part of the struggle here today is a struggle of values. Before her departure, our committee held a hearing with Secretary Nielsen. She denied the very fact that children were being held in cages when everyone could see it with their own eyes. These inhumane policies, which are simply the mandate given to an agency by an administration, and the family separation is just one of many that I believe have no place in our society. It is as though we are suffering with amnesia about the fact that so much of who we are is rooted in immigration. No, rather, who you are in this country outside of Native Americans and, of course, those who were brought through chattel slavery. So I just find it really interesting some of the conversation that we've been having today. When there weren't immigration laws, a whole heap of people came to the United States of America seeking freedom and liberty. They may have come from Europe, they may have come from other parts of the world, but they came and they were embraced. Well, you know, some of them struggled, but they became Americans. Under this administration, unfortunately, the mandate for DHS has focused on the attack on immigrants, has been focused on the attack on refugees. And while diverting resources and personnel away from what I believe are real threats, the wall we should be building is a firewall to defend our networks against cyber attacks. And while we spend a fortune on so-called border surge, we are failing to take basic precautions against another round of Russian interference in our elections. Schools and places of worship are under siege, and foreign and domestic terrorist groups are on the rise. But instead, Donald Trump is focused on what many believe, and I certainly do, is a fake threat of hardworking individuals seeking refugee status here in the United States of America. And that's not homeland security, that is demagoguery. So let me just ask a couple of questions. As acting secretary, you are now charged with the critical task of defending our elections from foreign interference. Your answer to Donald Trump, who denies that Russians interfered in the 2016 election. In an interview on Air Force One in 2017, the president said that Putin said he didn't meddle, and that Donald Trump said, I really believe when he tells me that he means it. Let me ask, does the Donald Trump statement conflict with the findings of DHS and all of our intelligence agencies that Russia did, in fact, interfere in the 2016 election?
The intelligence community's findings speak for themselves, but could I respond to some of your points you raised in your opening?
I just wanted to get through my line of questions. I don't have a whole lot of time, but I will yield to you once I get through those questions. Because my question is, how are we protecting ourselves? Sure. How does your budget reflect the need to protect ourselves, particularly from cyber intrusions by nation state?
So first of all, our 2020 budget request has, for the first time, has a specific line item for protecting elections. That said, we're not waiting for the 2020 budget. We've already launched the Protect 2020 initiative, trying to reach all 8,800 jurisdictions that oversee elections in this country. Maintaining our election integrity from a cyber perspective is a fundamental obligation of this department. I've had meetings multiple times a week since I've gotten this chair focused on that issue, and I have, I think,
well,
a great team at CISA.
Well, it's interesting because there is a, excuse me, Mr. Secretary, there's a $40 million cut in the cybersecurity infrastructure security agency's budget, and there is a $238 million cut to the science and technology directorate. So are you telling me you're going to do more with less? Is that essentially how that works?
Not precisely. The cut that you referenced is because we've completed development of one of the protective systems of the .gov network. That we don't need additional money to start the development. We're now just in an operations and maintenance phase with that. We do have new funding for personnel and for protecting the election infrastructure.
Okay. You said you had some comments.
Yeah, I don't believe we're failing in our counterterrorism mission or failing in our focus on cybersecurity. We are a multi-mission department. We have to do multiple things at the same time, 240,000 strong, with leaders across the department, our 8 operating components, all focused on different aspects of these mission sets. And I can tell you there's no attack on immigrants. There's no attack on refugees. There's a desire to secure our border. We're processing more asylum seekers than ever before as a nation. They're leading the world in processing of asylum seekers. So I didn't agree with the characterization.
Mr. Secretary, I thank you for your comments. I'm going to have to yield back, but I'm glad you can sit there and say that with a straight face, because there are a whole bunch of folk in America that just don't see it that way. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas for 5 minutes, Mr.
Thank
McCall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Acting Secretary, thank you for your service with CBP as well. And I can tell you, when I was chairman, like the height of the terror threat and the caliphate in 2015, 2016, the department, FBI, intelligence community did a phenomenal job stopping that terror threat, many of which no one will ever know about. But I actually have a question about the budget, since this is a budget hearing. And it has to do with sort of creative ways to pay for infrastructure and security at the United States border. Unfortunately, the bill I have with Chairman Goodlatte had failed on the floor. It had $25 billion in advanced appropriations. Now we're looking at what I consider to be a crisis. Can you tell me how much the budget is for both infrastructure and technology at the border? You may not know that offhand. If you don't, that's fine.
I referenced a number of those investments in my opening and in my written statement. And good to see you again. I appreciate your expertise and longtime support of DHS and our missions for security. We did request $5 billion for wall, about $500 million for additional investments in border security sensors and technology, surveillance capability, for instance, as well as our air marine platforms to have a better surveillance capability as well.
One of the ideas that we had, and I think it was also discussed by, I think, Mr. Kushner, was we were going to put in that bill something called a Border Security Trust Fund.
Right.
But instead, we opted for the advanced appropriation. But the idea is it's pretty simple, and to me, it kind of makes a lot of sense. A Border Security Trust Fund, all the fees that CBP collects at the border, most of those, as I understand it, go to the General Treasury and not back to the border. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Do you know how much is collected, say, on an annual basis with these fees?
Well, if you combine our trade mission with our merchandise processing mission, with our travel mission, we're talking well over $50 billion, well over the total funding requested for the entire Department of Homeland Security.
As it seems to me, you know, you're collecting this at the border. It should go not just for border security, but we have a lot of infrastructure issues. You know, when I go down to Laredo or McKell, you see the long line of 18-wheelers and processing, and we can have better technology down there and have better infrastructure in place. Currently, how much of that goes back to the border and how much of it goes to the general treasury?
A very small percentage goes back to the border. And if I could just offer that, I think the notion of a sustained fee-based investment in infrastructure, both to catch up with the deficit that we have for ports of entry, for instance, for border security technology, would be a tremendous idea. It was offered last week by the president in rolling out the immigration reform recommendations to members of Congress. But that kind of thing should be nonpartisan, to continue our investments without waiting on the vagaries of a budget cycle to make sure that we can enhance lawful trade and travel, as well as secure against narcotics, provide increased protections all along the border, is a very good concept and idea that I would support.
And I was going to ask if you did support that idea. I think this, Mr. Chairman, is a bipartisan issue. It's not political. It's just using a fee that's captured at the border to go to protect the border and build infrastructure. And it's self-sustaining, as you said. I get really, you know, we all don't look forward to the appropriation cycle and the shutdowns of the government and the cliffhangers and all the drama holding your department hostage with this kind of funding. And this will happen again, unfortunately, I think in September, if we don't do something creative like this to solve that problem in a responsible way without scoring political points or having the shutdown of the government, which I don't think anyone here supports that idea. I don't think it's ever productive to shut down the government. And then it just turns into, you know, finger pointing for political purposes. So I would suggest, Mr. Chairman, I would very much like to work with you and the ranking member on this idea, if you would be amenable to that. And I want to thank you for your service and your support for this idea as well. And with that, I yield back.
Thank you. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Missouri for 5 minutes, Mr. Cleaver.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Secretary, congratulations, and I wish you the best. I don't think anybody on this committee, and probably no rational American, would want less. So I wish you the very best. I'm concerned about the budget request, the cut, $270 million, and the reason I'm concerned about it is that I have become almost obsessed with TSOs and the fact that they are woefully and, in my estimation, dangerously underpaid. As I mentioned yesterday here at a hearing, they're the only thing that stands between most of us who fly airplanes every week and terror. And we treat them like they're insignificant. So I would, one of the requests that I have of you is that you would become the liberator, the agent of change for the TSA program. We've got to do something about the pay. And I hope that, you know, when the sun sets on your time in this position, that you can look back, I hope, I really hope, and say, I was able to do something with the TSO pay. Is that possible? Can you accept that?
So, first of all, I thank you for your comments on how important our transportation security officers are to our nation's aviation security and infrastructure. They are valued professionals. I do believe that as a department across the board, we need to do more to take care of the men and women who protect us every day, with retention incentives, with support for veterans programs, for suicide prevention, for childcare, really across the board. And I'm going to be looking at best practices at DHS, from each agency and seeing what I can do to make them the highest common denominator. And if there are pay issues that are not commensurate with the challenge our people face, I'll be happy to assess that and come back and work with this committee and others to see what we can do.
I think you're going to find that it's awful and it's ugly and makes us look bad. The other issue is there are reports that suggest white nationalism is a rising threat around the world, actually, and also here at home. And I hate trying to get into politics, but I have to on this one. I can't see any other way around it. But the president said that he did not see that as an issue. He said, when asked the question, he said, I quote, "I don't really." They asked him if they thought this was a threat. 3 years ago, my congressional office in Kansas City was firebombed twice. The gentleman has been apprehended. He's now serving 10 years in Leavenworth. My father keeps asking what's going to happen when he gets out. This is a personal issue, and I don't like to bring my personal business out here, but the point is, and I have to give the FBI were amazing in catching the guy. But if the president doesn't see this as a threat, and I personally know what happened to me, and I've seen and read about on the news what has happened around the country, and I'm not sure that I am absolutely certain that there are not good people on both sides. And so I'd like to know your assessment as the Homeland Security Secretary.
So our responsibility, Congressman, is to address targeted violence regardless of the motivation or ideology. And I am concerned about white supremacist extremists and the growing attacks, especially that we've seen on houses of worship. It's why I responded right away to the chairman and ranking member's challenge to ask the Homeland Security Advisory Council to set up a subcommittee to protect faith-based organizations and houses of worship. And they're going to bring a report back that tells us how we can improve our prevention efforts in this regard. And absolutely agree it's a problem, and we need to work to address it, not only at DHS, but with our investigative partners at the FBI and with state and local.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank the gentleman from Missouri. I want to thank the witnesses for their valuable testimony and the members for their questions. I'd like unanimous consent to enter into the record a statement from the National Treasurer's Employees Union. Without objection.
And Mr. Chairman, I'd also like
ranking member.
I mentioned earlier trying to get an amendment on the president's budget adopted, and it was denied. I'd like to put a copy of that in the record. Without objection.
Without objection.
Thank you.
The other thing I'd like to indicate is that on the Flores decision, it was about prolonged detention of children had proven to be harmful to their health. And the judge looked at that as the overriding factor as to why they shortened the time for detention. And so I think the court looked at it from that perspective rather than a punitive decision on the department, because we are concerned about the care of children who are in detention. The members of the committee may have additional questions for the witness, and we ask that you respond expeditiously in writing to those questions. Without objection, the committee record shall be kept open for 10 days. Hearing no further business, the committee stands adjourned.